Hello all. So yesterday you had the paper, no, 2021 UPSC CSAT. So in the CSAT, around like 34 questions were from normal mathematics functions, okay? Like a normal, what do we say, basic contents, not even the formula oriented and ideas oriented, just basic ideas. So once you know the fundamentals, you can easily solve all these 34 questions. But among those 34 questions, we are going to focus on 31 questions. Okay, so other questions have been discussed by the other faculty members. So we shall deal with the 31 questions here. Okay, so these are the questions which we will discuss now. Sixth question, we shall straight away go to the sixth question. Sixth question, a boy plays with a ball and he drops it from a height of 1.5 meter. Every time the ball hits the ground, it bounces back to attain a height of 4 by 5, 4/5 of the previous height. The ball does not bounce further if the previous height is less than 50 centimeter. Okay, so he drops the ball from 1.5 meter and it is stopped until after it reaches 50 centimeter, something like that. Okay, and what is the number of times the ball hits the ground before the ball stops bouncing? Okay, so from 1.5 meter it is reaching 4/5 of this height again and again, so until it reaches 50 centimeter or less than that. Okay, how many times it will hit the ground? Okay, basically this question paper belongs to part D, no, the session, the paper D. Okay, you had four papers among which we are dealing with the paper D. Okay, so sixth question, this is based on the mathematics, basic mathematics. We can solve it in terms of GP also, but we'll deal with the basic idea. I'll tell you the GP process little later. So first one, it is instead of 1.5 meter, let me have it as 150 centimeter. Okay, that's my first. Okay, first I'll drop the ball, it'll hit the ground, no? Second time, on the second bounce, okay, that's the first actually, okay, first part, that is, let's consider it as first bounce, okay, it is hitting the ground and come back, okay. So what is 4/5 of this 150? That is 80% of 150, that will be 120 meters, 120 centimeter. So this is 150 and this is 120 centimeter. Third, so second time it is hitting the round, 120. What is 80% of this 120? It is 96 centimeters. Then fourth, it will hit the ground and it will come back with its 4/5 of the length. Okay, what is 4/5 of 96? So approximately we can say it is 77. 76 point something will come. So let's say 77 centimeter. And then fifth turn. On the fifth hit, it will bounce back at the 4/5 of this 77 centimeter. So 80% of the 77 will be 61 centimeter approximately. It will be around 61 point something. So let's have 61 itself. And then sixth, 80% of this sixth will be 49 point something, 49.1, let's say 49.1 centimeter. But what is the condition? If it reaches 50 centimeter or below 50 centimeter, it will stop. It will stop bouncing. So it just bounce. It has bounced until these many centimeters. Okay, how many bounce it is bounced for before it reaches the ground? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So ultimately it will bounce for 5 times. Okay, it will hit the ground for 5 times, because first hit, in between this, first hit, second hit, third hit, fourth hit, fifth hit. On the fifth hit, it will be at the ground, right? It will not bounce back as per the condition. So on the fifth hit, it will be at the ground. So until the five hitting on the ground, the ball will bounce. On the fifth hit, it will not bounce. So the answer will be 5. Okay. Next question, it is 9. Integers are listed from 700 to 1000. In how many integers is the sum of the digits 10? So we need to add the digits, it has to become 10, right? So let me have the number from 700 to 1000, right? So let's have this. I need to find a number more than 700 but less than 1000. So let's start with 700 to 800. So 703, it will give you the sum to be 10. And I can split the numbers like this, 712 or 721 or 730. After that, it will not give you the sum 10. It will go beyond 10. Okay. So these four numbers from 700 to 800. After 800 until 900, we shall check with this. 802. Okay. 811 and then 820, and then beyond this it will not give you sum 10, and then 900s, 901 and 910. After that, it will not give you exactly the sum 10. So these set of numbers will give you the sum to be 10, sum of the digits to be 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 7, 9. So altogether, 9 numbers. When you add the digits of the numbers, it will give you 10. Okay, that's a 9th question. 10th question. Not 10, it's 16. Okay, consider all the 3-digit numbers without repetition of the digits obtained using 3 non-zero digits which are multiples of 3. So if you consider 3-digit numbers, all those 3 digits, no, those digits should be multiple of 3. Obviously the number should be, the digits should be 3, 6, 9. So these 3 are the digits which we are going to deal with. Okay, so you permute these numbers. Okay, you will have plenty other numbers with the use of 3, 6, 9 without repetition. So as per the basic combination process or permutation method of counting process, we'll have 3 factorial terms, right? So all those numbers you need to add it, you will get one sum, right? That's what they've given. Let S be their sum. Okay, so first we'll manipulate these numbers. You will get 369 and then 396. Then comes with 6, 639, 693. Okay, and then 936, 963. If I add all these numbers, I'll get one number. Okay, I want to get S, adding all these terms. Okay, so 9, 9, 18, 27, 36. Okay, everywhere 36, 3, 36, 9, 3, 36, 9, 39. So you'll get 3996. So the sum will be 3996. So this is my sum now. But what are the conditions? S is always divisible by 74. We need to check it out. And then S is always divisible by 9. Obviously, it is divisible by 9. We know that. But still, we need to check with the divisibility criteria for 74. I'll do one thing. We'll split it up. 3996. With the use of successive division, I'm going to do this. So, 3 times. 1, 3, 3, 2. Okay, 3. 4 times. Again, 4 times. 4 times. And then I'll go with 3 again. 1, 14, 20. 12 and then 24, 8, 148. And then I'll go with 2. Yeah, 74. Again, 2, 37. So from this I can tell it's 30, 74 is there now. So definitely the given number can be divided by 74. Right? It is possible. So 2 times of 37, it is possible. And this number is divisible by 74. It is possible. That's the first subdivision. Second subdivision or second conclusion they've given like that. S is always divisible by 9. Yeah, it is possible. It is also possible because it is divisible by 3, 3. Hence, it is divisible by 9 in a pair. Of course, yes. So, these two subdivisions are possible. As per the idea in the question, the answer is C. Okay. All right. Then comes 17th question. There are two classes A and B having 25 and 30 students respectively. So, class A. Class B. Okay, so class A have 25 students and here it is 30 students. Okay, in class A the highest score is 21, lower score is 17. So the range of marks is 17 to 21. Okay, here the range of marks in class B, the highest score is 30, the lower score is 22. 22 to 30. Okay, fine. 4 students are shifted from class A to class B. So, class A to class B, shifting is happening. 4 students are coming here. Okay. Consider the following statement. The average score of B will definitely decrease. The average score of A will definitely increase. Okay. We shall check with that. So, here, let's imagine the average score here is 20. Okay. The average score is 25 here. Let's imagine. Okay. So, if I take 4 people from this class, so here the average score was 25 as per my imagination. Here my average score is 20, the imagination as well. If I take 4 people from this class, definitely if I bring them here, the average score will decrease, correct? So even though the values are differing, average is 25. Since I'm including 4 people whose average score is 20, approximately imagining, okay. So if I include those four people whose score is 20, let's imagine that, definitely the average score of these people on the class B will decrease. Okay, so if I include these four people from class A to class B, definitely it will increase, decrease. The average score will decrease. So average score will decrease. That's one variety. But second condition, average score of class A will definitely increase. See, there were 20 people. No, here it is 25 people. There were 25 people whose average score is 20 as per our imagination. I took four people from the class. So 21 people would be there. We cannot be very sure about the score, whether it is increasing or decreasing. But here we can be very sure. But here we cannot be very sure. So here we can be very sure about that. We cannot be sure about this data class A. But class B, we can be very sure about it. So only two, option two follows. No, here option one follows, right? Yeah, one follows. That is option A only. That's your answer. Option A is the right answer. Okay. Then comes 25th. Yes. 3 to the power 2019 is divided by 10, then what is the remainder? So we have to focus on the unit digit. This belongs to basic unit digit formula. So 3 to the power 2019. Okay. So 3 is a 4 cycle category. Right? So 3 to the power 1, 3 to the power 2, it will be like this. 3 to the power 1, 3 to the power 2, 3 to the power 3, and 3 to the power 4. After that, the unit digit will repeat. Okay, I'll have to focus on the unit digit alone. So unit digit. So here it is 3. Unit digit here is 9. Unit digit here is 7. Unit digit here will be 1. Right? So after that, it will repeat. Right? So it will be a cycle. It's a cycle of 4. So I can split it in terms of cycles of 4 like this. 2016 plus 3. Right? So after these 2016 powers, it will repeat. So it will come to this part. 2016. 3 to the power 2016 will come here. And then 3 to the power 2017, 18, 19. So it has to end with 7. So you will have a number. Whenever I express this number, you will have a plenty of numbers, plenty of digits ending with 7. Okay, when I divide this number by 10, what could be the remainder? Obviously, so a remainder of the number dividing by 10 will give you the unit digit, obviously. Hence, the answer is 7. So this is your answer. Okay, then comes 26th. The number 37982553369 is divisible by 7. What is the value of the digit P? So we have to divide it. No other go. Okay, so we shall check with this 3798. I'll cut it down like this. 37. I'll check with the numbers before P. 3798125. Okay, so I'm dividing by 7. 35. It'll gone. It'll be gone. So no need to focus on the quotients. So remaining will be 29, right? 28 will be gone. So 18 will be there. 14 will be gone. 14 will be gone. And then 41 will be there. 35 will be gone. 62 will be there. 56 will be gone. And 65, 63 will be gone. Ultimately, 2 will be there. So you will focus on the remaining parts. That is 2, P, 3, 6, 9. So this number should be divisible by 7. So what is the possibility? Now you can focus on the options. So if I check with number 1, option A, you'll not get the value. If I check with number 6, that is option B. So P value will be 6 by using trial and error method. Option A and option B. I'm getting the answer P is 6. Okay. All right. Then comes 27th question. This 27th question is quite peculiar. So you will have to focus on two different areas and then combine it. Let's focus on the question. From Jan 1, 2021, the price of petrol in rupees per liter on mth day of a year, 80 plus 0.1 m, okay, where m is equal to 1234 until 100, and then thereafter remains constant. So it means the cost of petrol will be constant after 100th day. That is 100th day price would be there. No, that would be the constant value for rest of the days, whatever may be the number of days, whatever it is. Okay, so on 100th day you will have one price. That price will be constant forever after that. Okay, and then on the other hand, the price of diesel on nth day of 2021 is 69 plus 0.15 n for any n. Any n means n can be any other number. Obviously, it's a natural number, okay, because you're counting. So n is equal to natural number, even though m also, okay, but it is restricted to 100 only for m. N, it is natural number. And then on which day of the year 2021 are the price of these two fuels equal? Very simple. First, we'll focus on the petrol cost, okay, petrol. On the 100th day, it will be one value, right? After that, it will be constant. By looking at the options everywhere, see, look at this May. From Jan to May, approximately the value is more than 100, right? Yes or no? So, from Jan to 100, Jan plus 100 will be around April. Okay, definitely the values are all May. So, obviously the value, no, the number should be more than 100. So, M should be more than 100. I can fix the value, right? So, petrol cost will be like this, 80 plus 0.1 into 100. That is equal to 80 plus 10, 90. And it is always constant after that, after 100 day. From 101 today, 102, 102, 103, 104, likewise, it will be the constant value 90. And it has to be equal to the cost of diesel on a particular day. What is that day? We need to find out. Okay, this 90 should be equal to cost of diesel. That's what I want. Okay, what is the cost of diesel? It is 69 plus 0.15, right? 0.15 n. Okay, this is 90. If I bring it there, it will become 21. Okay, 21 equals to 0.15 n. I'll bring it there, I'll divide it. So 21 n is equal to, I'll get 21 by 0.15, which is 2100 by 15. Okay, so 4200 by 30, 420 by 30, I'll get 140. If I solve it, I'll get 140. Okay, so after I'm getting 140, that means on the 140th day from Jan 1st, okay, from Jan 1st, 140th day, what is the day? Including Jan 1, okay, including Jan 1, you're including that, okay, so Jan 1 will be one first day, and then after that, you'll include the value, right? So, what could be the day? I want to find that. Very simple. We can cut it down like this. From 140, I'm going to subtract the values of the month. Jan, we are including the Jan 1, right? So, Jan will have 31 days. Since it is 2021, it's a non-leap year. Definitely, February will have 28 days. March will have 31 days. April will have 30 days. Okay. So, we have to focus on May, right? Remaining value. We'll check on it. So, 30, 30, 30, let's say. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 120, and then 8 plus 1 plus 1, 20. So, 140, you will cut it down. The values will be cut down, you get 120. Okay. So, remaining will be 120. Hence, the value will be, what is that? May 20. If you subtract it, you will get the value. Okay. All right, then comes 28. Okay, a biology class at high school predicted that the local population of animals will double in size every 12 years. So, first 12 years, okay, in a 12 year, it will double. Okay, if it is 5, in 12 years, it will be 10. In 12 years, it will be 20. After 12 years, it will be 20. On the 24th year, it will be 20. Double, double. Okay, so the population at the beginning of the year 2021 was estimated to be 50 animals. Okay, at the beginning it is 50. Okay, so after 12 years it will be 100. After 12 years it will be 200. Okay, after 12 years it will be 400. It will go on like this. Okay, so the difference here is 12 years. Difference 12 years. Difference 12 years. Okay, right. So we shall create the cycle. If P represent the population after n years, okay, I want to find P, population after n years. Then which of the following equations represent the model of the class for the population? So, it will start with 50, right? 50, and it'll double. Double means two times. So it'll double for every 12 years. Okay, for the first 12 years, it will double. Okay, double. For the second 12 years, it will double for two times. Okay, for first 12 years, it will double. For the second, first 12, second 12. So in the 2 12 years, it will double for two times. Okay, so it will go on. So in that case, I can tell you like this, n by 12. How many ever year it is? Let's say 48 years. After 48 years, what will be the process? So 12, 12, 12, one more 12. So 4 12s will be there. Okay, so 48 will be cut into 4 times of 12. That's how I get it, 10 by 12. Okay, the answer is option D. This is how we'll solve. So for every 12 years, it is being doubled in the sense for 1 12 years, it's a cycle. How many cycles can I get from a from a given number of years? So n can be any other number. I took one example, 48. In 48 years, how many cycles can I get? Okay, n by 12, 4 cycles can I get? That's it. So this is your answer. Then comes 29. Okay. In a class, 60 students are from India and 50 students are girls. 30 students of the Indians are girls. Then, what percent of foreign students are boys? Okay. So first, let's imagine 100 students are there in the class. So Indian students and foreigners. Let's say like this. In that question, it is said that 60% are the Indian students. Obviously, remaining would be 40%. So let's focus on 100 itself. 100 students are there, 60% would be Indian and 40% would be foreigner. And then 50% of the students, 50% of these students are girls. So totally girls would be like this. Girls here, it is 50. 50% of 100, 50. So let's focus on 50 now. And now it is said that if 30% of the Indian students are girls, so here 30%. What is 30% of this one? So here girls, boys would be there. No. What is 30% of 60? I want to find that. 30% of 60. So what will I'll eliminate these zeros. I'll multiply 3 and 6. I'll get 18. Okay. So 18 are girls. Obviously, out of these 50 girls, I have to focus on these 18 girls. So I'll eliminate them. That's when I'll find the number of girls who are in foreigners, who are foreigners. Okay. So girls and boys. If in 50, 18 is gone, remaining will be 32, right? 32. Now we have to focus on these foreigners. Okay. So I've got 40 foreigners as per the calculation, among which 32 are girls. Remaining would be 8 boys. Okay. Fine. So if these are 8 boys, what is the question? How many boys are foreigners? Okay. What is the percentage they ask, right? What percent of foreign students are boys? Okay. Out of 40, 8 are boys. I need to focus on the percentage. 8 out of 40 are boys. Multiply by 100. So that's 1/5. 1/5 is nothing but 20%. Option D. Okay. That's how we get it. Then comes 39th. Okay. A person X from place A and another person Y from place B set out at the same time to walk towards each other. So, two places, place A, place B. So, from place A, person X is walking, and similarly, from place B, person Y is walking towards each other. Set out to walk towards each other. The places are separated by 15 kilometer distance. Okay, the distance between them is 15 kilometer. All right. X walks with a uniform speed of 1.5 kilometer per hour. Y walks with a uniform speed of 1 kilometer in the first hour, with the uniform speed of 1.25 kilometer in the second hour, with a uniform speed of 1.5 kilometer in the third hour. It will go on. It's like somewhat like arithmetic progression. First it is 1.5 kilometer, then it no first 1 kilometer, then 1.25 kilometer, and then 1.5 kilometer, and it will go on, right? Like 1.75, 1.5, something like that. So A will move on at the speed of 1.5 kilometer per hour, not a big deal. But this fellow, he'll walk by 1.1 kilometer in first hour, 1.25 kilometer in second hour, 1.5 kilometer in third hour, 1.75 kilometer in fourth hour. It goes on, not a big deal. It will go on. Okay. Which of the following are correct? Is and R are correct. So we'll focus on the first point. They take 5 hours to meet. Okay, let's imagine they're walking for 5 hours. If A walks for 5 hours, 5 hours. So I'll do like this. A for 5 hours. One speed into time will give you the distance, 7.5, right? B is walking for 5 hours. Here we cannot straight away use the formula. Here this guy is increasing the speed gradually, right? So B is increasing the speed gradually. So what is the distance covered by B in 5 hours? We'll focus on them. So first hour, second hour, third hour, fourth hour, and fifth hour. If I add them, what will be the value? 1.75, 1.25, it will be 3. Similarly, it will be 3. So altogether 6. 6 plus 1.5, 7.5. Yeah. So 7.5 A will cover, 7.5 B will cover. Altogether 15 kilometers would have been covered. So at the middle point, A, this guy would have covered, this guy would have, X would have covered 7.5 kilometer. Is it X or? Okay, so these okay, A B, instead of A B we can use X and Y. So person X and Y, person X, person Y. Person X would have covered 7.5 kilometer, person B Y would have covered 7.5 kilometer. So first clue, right. First condition, right. Second condition, they meet midway. Yeah, that's just before I told. They meet at the midway. Okay, 7.5 kilometer. See, in 15 kilometer, middle point is 7.5 kilometer. No, so they meet in the midway. Yes, midway. So both of them are correct. Hence, the option is option C. All right. Then comes 40. A student appeared in 6 papers. The maximum marks are the same for each paper. Let's imagine maximum marks to be 100. So maximum mark, let me imagine it is 100. Okay. Now his marks in these papers are in the ratio or in the proportion 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So let me imagine the value in between them is x. So let me have it like this: 5x, 6x, 7x, 8x, 9x, and 10x. Okay. Overall, he scored 60%. That is overall percentage. Adding all the values divided by 6 will give you the overall percentage, right? So that value is, what is 60% of 100? Okay, so you'll focus on this 60. Okay, overall value 60%. So let me imagine 60%, right? Let me imagine 60 itself. And then what is coming? The value here, in how many number of papers did he score less than 60% of the maximum marks? So you need to score values. Okay, we have got the values here. We need to get the value, the score of each subject. Among these subjects, how many subjects he has got the number of value, number less than 60, 60% of the maximum mark. Okay, so we'll focus on this. This will give, come here, it will be 360. And what is this value? 10, 5, 15, 15, 15. So 45. 45x is equal to 360, then x is equal to 45 double 90. So 90 into 4 will be 360. Hence it is 8. How did I get it? 45 times of 2 times of 4. 45 double 90. 90 times of 4 will give you 360. That's how I get it. So I'll focus on these 2 and 4. Hence it is x is equal to 8. Now I'll focus on the marks. So first subject, he would have got 4 times of 8 times of 5, 40. 6 times of 8 times of 6. So 48 multiples of 6. No, 56, 64, 72, and 80. Now what is the question? In how many subjects did he score less than 60% of the maximum mark? Maximum mark is 100. I imagine 60% of that is 60, less than 60, these 3 subjects. So the answer is 3 subjects. That's your answer. I believe option is B, PS in Bombay. All right. Then comes 43. J and Vijay spent an equal amount of money to buy some pens and special pencils of the same quality from the same store. If J bought 3 pens and 5 pencils, and Vijay bought 2 pens and 7 pencils, which of the following is correct? So very simple, they spent equal amount. So the number of pens and pencils bought altogether, okay, that will give you an amount, right? That amount will be equal for both J and Vijay. Okay, so J, let's say pens cost is X, pencils cost is Y. Let's take like this. So J would have bought 3 pens and 5 pencils. For the same amount, Vijay would have bought 2 pens and 7 pencils. 2 pens and 7 pencils. Right? Then we should find the answers. So let me bring x there, x part there, y part here. So 3x minus 2x will be 1x. 7y minus 5y will be 2y. So from this I can tell pens cost is double the time of pencils cost. So we'll check on the options. The price of pen is 2 times the price of pencil, option C. So from this I can tell option C is the right answer. Okay. Alright. Then comes 44th question. P scored 40 marks more than Q in an examination. Okay. If Q scored 10 marks lesser than P, then how much did Q score? See, very simple, they've given you two ways. First way, they've given you the difference between the marks. Second way, they've given you the difference between the percentage. Okay. So difference percentage is 10%, difference mark is 40. Okay, then what is 100%? 100% is 400. Okay. If P scored 400, 40 marks lesser will be Q, correct? So from this case, I can tell P scored 400 and Q would have scored 400 minus 40, then it is 360. So the answer is 360. And one more shortcut is there in this question. Q scored 10% lesser than Q, right? Sorry, P, right? So let's imagine P has scored 100% of whatever the mark scored by P is 100%. So 10% lesser than that would be 90% of the mark, right? So Q would have scored 90% of what P has scored, correct? So 90, it should be 90% of the mark, or 90 is multiple. Look at the options. Among the options, only one option is the multiple of 90. Okay, it's a rude example. Among the options, it is 90. Okay, it should be a multiple of 90. Only option A is 9, multiple of 90. So option A is a multiple of 90, or based on the calculation, it is obviously 360. Okay. So 44, then 45. A person P asked one of his three friends X as to how much money he had. Okay, X replied, if Y gives me 40. So there are three people there. X, Y, Z. Three people. They have the money. Let's imagine X has the money, X rupees. Y has the money, Y rupees. Z has the money, Z rupees. Okay. So X is telling, if Y gives me 40. If Y gives me 40, that is X minus 40, X plus 40. So X is getting 40 from Y. So whatever the money Y had, 40 will be lessened. That's how we get it. And then Y will have half of as much as Z. So in this moment, Y will have Z by 2. This is my first equation. So that's comparison. They are not equal. In fact, this is one complete scenario, different scenario. These two are different scenarios, but they are compared. Compared in the sense, if Y gives 40 to X, Y will have Y minus 40. That value is half of Z value. Whatever the Z value Z has, half of that. Okay, next, if Z gives me 40, so I'm reducing 40 from Z, so increasing 40 to X, then three of us will have equal amount. So then three of us will have equal amount. Right? So that's my equation number 2. Now I'm going to do only one simple equations. So this Y, you know, this is equal to Z minus 40 as per the second scenario. I'm going to use the Z minus 40 here. So using 2 in 1. Okay. So using 2 in 1. So let me do one thing. I'm going to use 2 in 1. So this part alone, I'm going to use this part alone. So Z minus 40 minus 40 equals Z by 2, right? 2Z minus 80, 2Z, okay, minus, this will be 80, no? So double it, it'll become 160. 160 is equal to Z. So I'll bring it here, then Z is equal to 160. If Z is 160, I'm going to put it here. When, what is Y? So second equation will give you like this. Y is equal to 160 minus 40. So 120. Right? So I'm going to use anywhere else here. So Y is equal to 120. No, y is equal to 120, x plus 40 is equal to 120, I can tell. So x plus 40 equals to 120, from this I can tell x is equal to 80. So I have got x, y and z. Now what is the question? What is the total amount of money that x, y, z have? So I need to add all these things, 80 plus 120 plus 160. I need to add x plus y plus z. So 80 plus 120, 200, 200 plus 160, 360. So all the three will have 360, the amount is B, 36, 360, option is B. Then comes 47, at which of the following times do the hour hand and the minute hand of the clock make an angle 180 degree with each other? It's a factual question. For every 65, 5 by 11 minutes, okay, every 65 5 by 11 minutes, okay, the hands will be exactly 180 degree, okay, will make another the same angle, okay. So let's say 6 o'clock, at 6 o'clock it would have made 180 degree, excuse me, and then after that, after 65 5 by 11 minutes, that is 75 5 by 11, so at exactly at 6 o'clock plus 65 5 by 11 minutes. So what is the time? It is 7 5 5 by 11, that's how we get it, right? So this is how we will have 7 5 5 by 11 minutes, let's say. So as per this idea, we can tell option D is the right answer. Otherwise, if this is one variety, we can equate the value with the use of formula. What is the formula? Theta equal to modulus of, or even leave the modulus, 30 into hours minus 11 by 2 minutes. Okay, if it is theta, it is 180, they said in the question itself. 30 after 7 only, they said, minus 11 by 2 minutes. It will be 210. If it goes there, you will get 30. Okay, so you will have it like this, 11 by 2 times of minute equals to 30. Then m is equal to 60 by 11, which is 5 by 11. That is 7 after 7. 5 5 by 11 minutes, after 7 5 5 by 11 minutes. So this is another procedure, okay. So 7 5 5 by 11 minutes, so it is option D. In both the ways you get the same answer, option D, okay. 48, in an objective type test, 90 questions of 19 questions, 5 marks for the right answer, 2 marks for the wrong answer, okay. After attempting all the 90 questions, a student got total of 387 marks. Okay, so what is the question? What is the number of incorrect answers? So I want to find the incorrect numbers. So correct answer, correct, incorrect. So I want to find this incorrect, no, let's say x. So totally how many questions are there? 90 questions are there, among which x will be incorrect. So remaining will be correct, no, so 90 minus x. Right. For every correct answers, you will get 5 marks. So 5 times of 90 minus x. And for every wrong answers, you will lose 2 marks. So losing 2 marks in the sense, minus 2x equals to, altogether this guy has got 387 marks. Okay. Then solve it further, we will get the answer. This is 450 minus 5x minus 2x, 387. So let me bring this value here. It is 7x. And if I bring it there, 450, 387, you will get 13 here, then 50, 63. So x is equal to 9. The answer is 9, option A. So you would have got 9 answers wrong. Alright. Then comes 49. Consider the following addition problem. 3P, 4P, PP, PP. 3P, 4P. PP and BP. The result is RQ2. Right. Now, where P, Q, R are different digits, what is the arithmetic mean of all such possible sums? So, we need to find such possible sums so that we will be able to find arithmetic mean. Okay. Very simple. I am adding P, 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 I am getting 2. So, if I add 4 P's, I will get 2. What are the possibilities? Either it will be 3 4s are 12 ending with 2, or 8 4s are 32 ending with 2. So I can have either P equals to 3 or P equals to 8. So if it is p equals to 3, what is the sum? So that's my condition first. 33, then 43, then 33 plus 33. So what will be the value? 33, 33, 63, 69, 69, then 72, 72 plus 70, 142. That's what you have. What if it is 8? 38 plus 48 plus 88 plus 88. 80 plus 88, 176. 176 plus 8, 176 plus 40, 216. 216 plus 8, 224. 224 plus 8, 232, 252, 262. Okay, so we got this value. And anything other possible values? No, it is not at all possible. So only these two values will give me 2 at last as a unit digit. Okay, find the arithmetic mean of such possible sums. I need to find the arithmetic mean of these two values. We need to add these two values first. So what is the value? 4, 10, okay, then 1, 4. So 404 is the sum. I want to find the arithmetic mean. So arithmetic mean equals to 404 divided by sum of terms divided by number of terms. Only two terms are there, 2. Hence it is 202. Option C. Okay. 50th question. Consider the following multiplication problem. PQ into 3 equals to RQQ. PQ multiplied by 3 equals to RQQ. Alright. PQR are different digits. R is not equal to 0. Alright. What is the value of P plus Q divided by R? P plus R divided by Q. Okay. See here, I need to multiply that particular number with 3 so that I will get the same number. Okay. So only possibility is, two possibilities are there, either 0 or 5. If I put 0, it will be 0, 0. Okay. So if I take some other value, if I put 0 here, I will not get particular value for R. Okay. Say for example, so what if it's 0? So Q is equal to 0. Let me take this condition. P into 0 multiplied by 3 will give you R 0, 0. It is not at all possible for the case. Okay. If you put any other value, any value, 1, 2, 3, 4, any value, it will not be possible forever. Okay, so this condition is not possible. Hence, I have to focus on Q is equal to 5. So 5 multiplied by 3, something with 5 multiplied by 3 will give you R 5 5. Okay, so focusing on the values now. If I'll pick the values, so it should be, it should not be 5. It should be other than 5. The P value should be other than 5. So I focus on the value which is more than 5, so that I'll get a triple digit number, right? So if I focus on that, I'll get 8 times. So 8, if you multiply them, it will be 255. So from this I can tell P is equal to 8, Q is equal to 5, then R is equal to 2, right? Now I want to find the value of P plus R by Q. P plus R by Q, that's the question. 8 plus 2 by 5, 10 by 5, it is 2. The answer is B. So this is all about trial and error only. Okay. So after using the values, we get the answer. Then 54. Okay. A pie diagram shows the percentage distribution of proteins, water, and other dry elements in the human body. Pie diagram. Okay. Protein, water, and other dry elements. Okay. Protein correspond to 16% and water correspond to 70. So let's say 16% protein, water correspond to 70%. So let's say 16, 70 is gone, remaining will be 14, right? So remaining 14, let's say 14%. So that's my dry area. Altogether it is 70%. That is my water area. So water belongs to 70%, 16% protein, other elements, only 3 elements are given, right? So other dry elements will be 14, remaining part. Okay, and then if both proteins and other dry elements correspond to P percentage, so we need to combine these two. So combining these two, we get, so 70 gone out of 100%, 70 gone, remaining will be 30%. So P percentage equals to 30%, or even if you add these two values, 16 plus 14 will be 30 eventually, not a big deal. And then what is the question? Then what is the central angle of the sector representing P on the diagram? So we need to find the angle of this. So out of 360 degree, what is 30%? I want to find that. I want to find this 30% area and 30% angle. Okay, inclined angle. I want to find the angle part. 30% of 360. Okay, so I'll get like this 30 by 100 times of 360. Solving them and I'll get 108. Okay, 108 degree, option C. Okay, 56th question. The difference between two digit number and the number obtained by interchanging the positions of the digits is 54. So we know that normally a number, normal number would be of the form, normal two digit number would be of the form 10x plus 5. So reverse number would be of the form 10y plus x. If I subtract them, if I find the difference between them, I'll get 54, they said, right? So 10x plus y minus 10y plus x equals to 54, they said. So bringing minus inside, I'll solve. I'm solving them. 10x minus x will be 9x. 10y minus 9, y minus 10y will be minus 9y equals to 54. Hence, I can tell dividing by 9 throughout. Right, because all the numbers are multiple of 9, and they'll get x minus y equals. So this is my ultimate conclusion based on the data given in the question. Now look at the statements. First statement: the sum of the two digits of the number can be determined only if the product of two digits is known. Okay, so if I know x minus y, if I know xy part, I can get x plus y with the use of formula. So first subdivision says, so formula is like this: x plus y whole square. X plus y whole square equals to x minus y whole square plus 4xy. Okay, if I want to find the x plus y, sum of the values, provided I can get xy. Yes, I know the value of x minus y, 6. If I get xy, I'll get x plus y. That's possible. So it is possible. First clue, it is possible. Second clue, the difference between the two digits can be determined, can of the numbers can be determined. Yes. Difference between, second, I can either get x difference y, that is, I can get x minus y or y minus x, both of them are possible. Difference between them, yes, x minus y is 6. What if I reverse the possibility, y minus x will be 6 or even minus 6, not a big deal. I can find it. It can be determined. Option A is also possible. First subdivision is also possible, second subdivision is also possible. Hence option C, both 1 and 2. Okay, and then 57th question. X said to Y, at the time of your birth, I was twice as old as you are present. Okay, so present age of X, present age of Y, let's say. Okay, so at the time of birth of Y, so present age of X, let's say Y. Okay, so at the time of birth of Y, that means you're traveling back to Y years. Okay, so at the time of, let's say Y's percentage is 5. At the time of birth of Y, what will happen? You need to go back 5 years, right? You need to go 5 years back, right? So in that case, whatever may be the age of X, you need to subtract Y so that you will get the age of X at the time of birth of Y. Could you get that? I'll tell you again. Let's imagine age of Y is 5. Okay, so I want to find the time or the age of X when Y is born. So that is, you need to go back 5 years. Okay, so X minus 5 will be there, no? So it is just Y. So you need to go back Y years. So at the time of birth of Y, age of X is X minus Y. Okay, at the time of birth of Y, age of X is X minus Y. He told like that, is twice, I was twice as old as you are at present. What is the percentage of y? Y, no? 2 times of y. Okay. We can check like this. Or even we can use some other values. If you get confusing, I'll tell you on the value. So let's take A and B. A, B. Okay, at the time of birth of Y. So subtract B years from age of A. So 2 times of y is h at present. Y is h at present is b, no? 2 times of b. So from this I can tell a equals to 3b. So this is my ultimate conclusion based on the data given. Okay, 8 years ago the age of x was 5 times as old as y. We'll check it. So here they've given you the age of x also. If the present age of x is 42 years, it is 42. Okay, so we need to check with this. So 42 equals to 3b. Okay, from this I can tell b equals to 42 by 3, it is 14. So age of a is 42, age of b is 14. We have this. So let's have this clue. A equals to 42, b equals to 14. So we have got these things. First clue says, what is the first clue says? 8 years ago, so minus 8 years. So A's age would be 34, B's age would be 6. A's age is 5 times the age of Y. It is not possible. It should be 30. No, it is not possible. First condition, it is not possible. Second condition, after 14 years, so we need to add 14 years. So A's age, age of X would be 42 plus 14, 42 plus 14 will be 56. Age of B, age of Y, B value is 14 plus 14, 28. We got these two values, no? Now, what is the question? X would be twice the age of Y. Yes, age of A is, age of X is 2 times the age of Y. Yes, 28 into 2 will be 56. It is possible. So, from this we can tell only B, that is option B, 2 only. Then comes 58. The price of an article is decreased by 20% and then a new price is increased by 25%, then what is the net change in the price? So first it is decreased by 20%. Yeah? So A, it is decreased by 20% minus 20. B, it is increased by 20%, 25% plus 25. So we have the combined variation formula. What is the combined variation formula? A plus B plus AB by 100. So whenever we have decreased, minus, you put minus value. Whenever we have increased, you put plus value. You just put the values here, you will get the form, you will get the answer eventually. So minus 20 plus 25 plus minus 20 into 25 by 100. Okay, so this for 5 times, this for 5 times, you will get minus 5 here. Here you will get plus 5. 5 minus 5, it is 0. Ultimately, there is no change at all, 0%. Or even I can go with the proper number. So let's say the price is 100. Okay. So first it is 20% decrease. If it is 20% decrease, what is the value? It will be 80. Then 25% increased. So from this, what is 25%? 1/4 of 80. 1/4 of 80 is plus 20. Okay. So it is 25%. 180 plus 20. So here you get 100 minus 20. Here 80 plus 20. It is again 100. So at the beginning it was 100 and at last it is again 100. There is no change at all. That is 0%. You can tell that. Then 59th. When a certain number is multiplied by 7, the product entirely comprises only once only. Okay. What is the smallest such number? See, among these options, you should go by trial and error method only. So option D will give you the right answer. That is 15873. Multiplying by 7. When you multiply this term by 7, you will get 6 ones, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This would be your answer. So by trial and error only, you will get the answer, 56, 59th. Then comes 60th. A man completes 7/8 of a job in 21 days. Okay. So 7/8 of a job, let's say X equals to 21. Then X is equal to 24, because this is for 3 times. I bring it there, you will get 24. That is 24 days. So let's imagine I'll eat one chocolate in one day. So I'll have 24 days. So I'll eat 24 chocolates in 24 days. That's my ultimate assumption. Let's have it. So I had 24 chocolates. Okay. What is happening? I ate 21 chocolates because I've done the work in 21 days. So remaining 3 chocolates would be there. So out of 24 chocolates, 21 chocolates are done. 21 days of work is done. Remaining 3 days of work is there pending. Okay, I need to take 3 more days to complete the work. But what is happening here? Okay, how many more days will it take to him to finish the job if the quantum of work is, quantum of work means the basic work, basic work is 24 days of work, right? 24 chocolate, let's say. This 24 is increased or decreased, further increased by 50%. So this 24 workers increased by 50%. Then what is the value? What is 50% of 24? It will be 12, right? So 24 plus 50% of 24, it will be 12, 36. That means at the day, on the 21st day, I'm realizing that I have 36 works to be done altogether, out of which I've done 21 days of work. Okay, so out of 36 days of work, I have done the works of 21 days. Okay, remaining will be 15 days of work. So this is based on basic idea, not even time and work process, basic idea. Okay, so 24 days, the work is to be done in 24 days. Okay, let me imagine one day, one chocolate, 24 days, 24 chocolates. On the 21st day, I'm completing 21st chocolate. The work is increased from the quantum work. Quantum work is ultimate basic job. Ultimate basic job is 24. 50% increase means plus 12, it is 36. Okay, it is supposed to be 24, but it is becoming 36. Out of 36, already I'm done with 21. Remaining will be number of chocolates. That says number of works. Okay, remaining will be 15 chocolates. So 15 chocolates I have to eat. If I eat only one chocolate in one day, how many days will I take? 15 days. That's it. Okay, that is option D. Okay, 65. This is data interpretation. Yes, you've got these values, right? Player runs scored in the first innings, balls faced in the first innings. Runs scored in the second innings, balls faced in the second innings. You've got the data, A, B, C, D. Okay, who is the fastest run scorer in the test match? So we need to check with the total run scored and total number of balls faced. We need to find the percentage. Very simple. So let's take A. A has scored 61 plus 14. 61 plus 14 runs while facing 99 plus 76 balls. 99 plus 76 balls. In the first innings, he scored 61 runs facing 99 balls. In second innings, he scored 14 runs facing 76 balls. Altogether, he would have taken 61 plus 14, that is 75 runs. 75 runs facing 175 balls, multiplying by 100 so that you'll get a percentage. Okay, so in terms of 25 table, 3 times, 8 times. Oh, no, it is 7 times. Yeah, 25. In terms of 25, 25 into 7, 135. Done. So on this, 1/7 is 14.28. So multiplying by 3, you'll get 42.84%. Okay, so we have got 42.84%. That is his run rate. Okay, run rate in terms of percentage. And then B. This man B has scored 5 runs in the first innings, 50 runs in the second innings. He faced 12 balls in the first innings, 85 balls in the second innings. Okay, so 55 out of 97 multiplying by 100, so it would be approximately 56, because 55 by 100 will be 55%. No, because since the denominator is getting reduced, the total value will be more, little more. Okay, approximately. So I can tell this is approximately 56%. So let's approximate it, maybe like more or less 1% or 0.5% plus or minus, it's not a big deal. So we'll have 56% of B. For B, for C, 15 and 20. For C, he scored 15 runs and 20 runs while facing 75 and 50 balls. 75 and 50 balls. So you will get it like this: 35 divided by 125 multiplied by 100. Okay. In terms of 5 table, I can cut down. 5 sevens are, and 5 into 25 are. Okay. This is for 4 times. 7 was at 20, exactly 28%. Not a big deal. And then comes D. 13, 12. So 13 runs in the first innings, 12 runs in the second innings, while facing 55 and 50 balls. 55 and 50 balls. Okay. So 25 runs while facing 105 balls, multiply by 100. So this is approximately 24%, right? So 25 by 105. Approximately 23 to 24%. So I'll write it like this. approximately 24%. Whatever may be the value, not a big deal. But look at these fellows. So among these fellows, who has got the highest percentage? So this B, that means B would score highest value, highest run. Okay. So that means B is the fastest run scorer. So B is the fastest run scorer. The answer is B, option B, B. Option B is the right answer. Okay. Okay, then comes 73. There are 3 points. This is based on this coordinate geometry PQR on a straight line such that PQ is to QR. Okay, PQ is to QR equals to 3 is to 5. That's what you have. All right. If n is the number of possible values of PQ is to PR, PQ is to PR. Okay, then what is n is equal to? I'll tell you. So first let's take a straight line. They've given you the straight line, right? So let's take P Q R. Okay, so what is PQ? It is 3. What is QR? It is 5. So from this I can tell PQ is to PR. What is PQ by PR? Instead of ratio I can have it like this, fraction. So PQ is 3. What is PR? Whole value. It is 8. That's one value. So this is one possibility. Other one, I can have like this. Since QR is more, I'm taking like this. Q here, R here, P here. Okay. All together, QR is 5, right? And PQ is 3. If it is 3, it will be 2. So that the whole value will be 5. The QR is equal to 5. In that, PQ cut off 3. Okay. So remaining will be 2. From this, I can tell you like this. PQ by PR, it is also possible that you get 3 by PQ is 3, PR is 2. Is there any other possibility? No, even if you reverse it, you will get the same possibility, reciprocal of that. That's not the possible, that's not the way we need to find it. So these two are basic possibility, basic proportional part we need it. And then what are the number of possibilities? N is equal to 2. So only 2 possible, 1, 2, option B. That's your answer. Two possibilities are there. Then comes 76th. Okay, 2 2 3 3 3. So these are the numbers 2 2 3 3 3. These are the numbers. How many distinct numbers greater than 30,000 can be formed? So 30,000, no. So 1 2 3 4 5. So these five numbers, six numbers should be there. Is it? 1 minute. 5-digit number, 30,000. 5-digit number should be there. It has to be more than 30,000. So obviously it should be 3. You just freeze the number, no other go. And then these four numbers can be manipulated. So I've just fixed one number, not a big deal at all. Now these four numbers can be manipulated by these four numbers, these four places. Okay. So those four numbers can be arranged in four factorial ways, and 3 is repeated for 2 times, and this 2 is repeated for 2 times. Since we fixed it, we have frozen this 3. No need to worry about this. We need to worry about these 4 places. Among these 4 places, I need to manipulate these 4 numbers. Whereas 2 repeated for 2 times and 3 repeated for 3 times. Solving them, you get like this. So this is 24 and 2 into 2. Solving them, you get 6. Option B. That's your answer. Okay. 77. Consider the following statement. First one, sum of 5 consecutive integers can be 100. It is possible. How? I'll tell you. So first number, 18 plus 19 plus 20 plus 21 plus 22. Sum of 5 consecutive numbers can be 100. It is possible. Yes. They didn't tell you should be. Can be. It is possibility. Yes, it is possible. First one is possible. Second substitution, the product of 3 consecutive natural numbers can also be equal to their sum. Yeah, that's also possible. Let me take 1 into 2 into 3 is equal to 1 plus 2 plus 3. 6, this is also possible. Both of them are possible. Okay, so these two are possibility. They are focusing on the possibility only. They didn't tell you the condition. It is not should be or must be. It is can be. Yeah, it is possible. Hence, both A and B. So option C is the right answer. Okay. Then comes 78. A cubical vessel of side 1 meter is filled completely with water. So volume is equal to 1 cube. Okay. Volume is equal to cubical vessel, no? So 1 cube. 1 into 1. So 1 cube. 1 meter cube. Because 1 meter they said, right? Cubical vessel. Okay. How many milliliters of water is contained? Okay. First we need to focus on the liters and then we'll get milliliters. 1 meter cube of space will occupy 1000 liters of water. 1000 liters of liquid. Okay. So 1000 liters, how many milliliters do we need? 1000 times of 1000 milliliter. Because 1 meter cube is equal to 1000 liters and 1 liter is equal to 1000 milliliter, right? Solving them, we get the answer. That is 10 lakh. 10 lakh milliliters we have. That is option D. Okay, 78, then 79. There are 6 persons arranged in a row. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So, okay, another person, let me be the person, has to shake hand with 3 of them so that he should not shake hand with 2 consecutive persons. I should not take this possibility, 1, 2 or 2, 3 or 3, 4 or 3, 4, 5 or 4, 5, 6. Not that possible. Okay. And then, in how many distinct possible combinations can the handshakes take place? Very simple. I can take like this. 1, 3, 5. That's one possibility. So, I shake the hands of first person, third person, fifth person. That's one possibility. Or 1, 3, 6. That's another possibility. First person, third person, sixth person. Because they are not next to each other. Okay. And then one more possibility is there, 1, 4, 6, starting from first guy. Okay, suppose if we start from second guy, 2, 4, 6, that's the only possibility, nothing else. So, 2, 4, 6, that's another possibility. Okay, if I start with 3, 3 will be there, either I can go with 1 and then 6 or 3, 1, 5, all these possibilities will come here itself. So, these are the basic possibilities. How many terms are there? 4 terms, 4 times or 4 turns, let's say. So, I have 4 varieties, 4 chances. So, option B. And then, yeah, last question. An amount of money was distributed among ABC in a ratio PQR. Okay. Consider the following statement. A gets maximum share if P is greater than QR. Whenever you get such ideas, you think in terms of counter example, negative examples, okay, which will disprove it. Okay, we'll first focus on this actual basic idea. So A gets maximum share if P is more greater than QR. So let's take PQR. PQR. That's the first subdivision. Let's take this. So let's take 10, 5, 3. What is the condition they said? A gets maximum share. So PQR is there, no? They're all lower cases. PQR. A gets maximum share. So, A share is P, B share is Q and C share is R. Right? So, A gets maximum share if P is greater than Q plus R. That's possible. 10 is greater than 5 plus 3. It is possible. Okay. Can. Okay. It is possible. Can be. Next one. C gets minimum share if R is less than P plus Q. Second subdivision. P, Q, R. C gets minimum share if R is less than P plus Q. So, let me take 9, 3, 5. Let me take some other value like this. So, here what is the possibility? R is less than P plus Q. So, 9 plus 3 is, it is possible. But look at this. Among these ratios, these parts, 9 parts, 3 parts, 5 parts, who will get the least value? Q will get the least amount. Okay, but in the question, it is given that R will get the least value. It is not possible, right? So, this is not the condition. So, we get counter example. This is counter example. Okay. So, this one is possible. This one is not possible. So, option 1 only. So, A. Right answer. Okay. So, that's it, guys. And I will remind again, this belongs to paper D. Okay. So, paper D. That's it. Thank you.
Hello everyone. In this video, we are going to discuss the reasoning part of CSAT 2021 question paper. I'm going to discuss this question number 5, 7, 8, 15, 18. Okay, so these questions we are going to discuss. We'll start with question number 5, it's syllogism. Okay, this is question number 5. Some cat or Almira, some Almira or chairs. So now some part of chair is connected with Almira, right? So this chair may have connect with cat also. Okay, so instead of drawing two diagram, I'm just drawing it as one diagram. The chair may have connection with cat, which means like it could be like this or it could be, when you're connecting chair with Almira, it may connect cat also. So instead of drawing these two diagrams, I have drawn only one diagram. It means that this dotted line means that this chair and cat may have connect with each other. Okay, so now conclusion 1 says that certainly some almiras are table. There is one more sentence, that all chair are table. Okay, so since if suppose chair is having connect with cat, this table may also be having connect with cat. Okay, so conclusion 1 says that certainly some Almira are table. Almira is connected with table. Yes, there is some connection between Almira and table all the time. Okay, so first conclusion is right. Second conclusion, if you take that, it says some cat may not be chairs. So we don't know whether chair and cat is connected or not. Okay, it may have connect or may not have connect. So if the connect is not known exactly between two words or two variables, it could have any kind of connect. Okay, like it could have complete connect with each other or partial connect with each other, or there may not be any connection, or they may not be like partial disconnection. Okay, anything could be there. So they mentioned the word, it is to be may. Okay, some cats may not be chair. So may itself means that anything is possible. Okay, so if something is not known very clearly, anything is possible. Okay, so that's what they are saying. It may not be chairs. Okay, since they mentioned the word may, we can take it to be right. Okay, so both conclusions are right. So fifth one, C is the answer. Okay, C, option C is the answer. Next, we'll see the seventh one. Images of consonants of English alphabets are observed in the mirror. Okay, so first let us write the English alphabets. Okay, they have clearly mentioned that you have to take only the consonants, so you should not take the vowels. A, E, I, O, U. These things should not be counted. Okay. Next, and you have to count the one which is not looking like its original image. So you're going to take the mirror image of each and every letter, and which should be considered is which is different from their original image. Okay, so what's different from its original image? You have to just say, for example, if you take B, the mirror image of B is this. Okay, both look different, so you can take this. But if you take V, the mirror image, hope everyone knows what is mirror image. Mirror image is turning the image from right to left. It looks the same only. Okay, if you turn V, the mirror image of V is V itself. So you should not take this into consideration. Okay, so which one can't be taken into consideration is H, because mirror image of H looks the same. Mirror image of M looks the same. Mirror image of T looks the same. Mirror image of V looks the same, you should not take it. And mirror image of W looks the same, you should not take it. And mirror image of X also looks the same, you should not take it. So others could be considered. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Okay, so 15 is the answer. Seventh one, option C. 15 is the answer. Okay, eighth one, it's a direction based question. A person is driving 10 km towards south, then 20 towards left side, then again 40 towards left side, then 5 km towards right side, then again right side, 30. So how far is the person from the starting point? Well, shortest distance is like a straight line has to be taken. It should be measured. Okay, shortest distance is that only. So starting from here, the person is going towards south, 10 kilometers. So this is left side, 20. And again, this is left side for the person, 40. And this is right side. 5, and again this is right side. So when you're drawing the parallel line, you should be very careful that this entire line is 40 and this parallel line is 10. So from here to here it's 30, correct? Till this it's 10, because the here it's 10. So till this it's 10, so remaining this portion has to be 30. When you're drawing parallel line for 30, it should be ending here itself. Okay, you should not extend the line. So now this starting point, ending point, we have to measure this distance. Okay, this distance has to be measured, which is from here to here it's 20, from here to here it's 5, so totally it's 25. Okay, next question, number 15. There are 120 persons in a group. So 80 people are Indian and remaining 40 are foreigners. And again, in that 120, 70 people can speak English, which means the remaining 50 persons cannot speak English. They don't know English. Okay, so which means the Indians who can speak English. Okay, so it's about speaking English. So there are 70 people who can speak English, and out of that, how many are possibly Indians is the question. Okay, so if suppose you take the least possible case, that all the 40 foreigners know English. Okay, they know English. So remaining 30 should be definitely Indians only. Okay, we are taking the least possible case that if all the foreigners knows English, so remaining 30 people, Indian should speak English. English no. So minimum 30 Indians will speak it for sure. It's like definitely they will speak English. So 30, it could be more than that also, because we don't know whether all these 40 foreigners knows English. Okay, even if it is 39, the count will here increase to 31. Okay, anyways, it's going to be more. Fine. So 30 or more is the answer. Next question number is 18. Syllogism. sorry, it's not syllogism, it's like based on seating arrangement and ranking. Priya is fourth rank below Seema, and she is 31st from the bottom. And the question is, this is data sufficiency question, so we'll go from the question. The question is, what is Seema's rank? What is Seema's rank is the question. What is Seema's rank from the top in a class of 40 students? Okay, the entire class contains 40 students. If Priya is fourth rank below Seema and is 31st from the bottom, okay, so Seema, okay, so Priya's here and she is 31st from the bottom, so which means there are 30 students below Priya, and Priya is 4 ranks below Seema. Okay, 1, 2, 3, and Priya is the 4th rank. So now from this you can find out what is the rank of Seema. Okay, we don't have to find out the actual answer, but we should know that this is answerable. Okay, using statement number 1 we can find out what is Seema's rank. It's possible. So first statement is enough, okay, to find out the answer, but we have to check the second one also, because there is an option called either 1 or 2. Either 1 or 2 means individually using 1 also you can find out, or individually using 2 also you can find out. Okay, okay, so now if you take statement 2, so statement 1 is useful to find out the answer. Using that you can find out. Statement 2 is again the same. Ina is 2 ranks above Seema and is 37th from the bottom. So Ina is 37th from the bottom, so there are 36 persons below. This is 37th rank and Ina is 2 ranks above Seema. Okay, so using this you can find out what is Seema's rank. Okay, again telling you, you don't have to find out what the answer is, but then using this you can find out the answer. So individually using this also you can find out, or using this, so either using that or this. So 18th one, C is the answer. Okay, 19th one, for this the answer is A, because here again this is data sufficiency question. Who is the heaviest among ABC? Who is the heaviest is the question. And if you take statement 1, it is given A and D is heavier than B, E, F, but none of them is heaviest. Okay, so A and D both are more than B, E, F, but none of them means these two people. Okay, these two people are not heaviest. So it clearly says that these people are not going to be after these people. These people are going to be after these people, but these two are not the heaviest person. So obviously the person who is left out is person C. That person is possibly the heaviest person. Okay, so among all the 6 person, these 3 people are not heaviest, because it is after A and D, and it is clearly mentioned that A and D are also not the heaviest. So obviously the other one, person C, has to be the heaviest one. So using statement 1 you can find out what the answer is. Okay, so that alone is sufficient, but if you try for the other options it won't work out. Okay, you can just try and see. 20, so in the English alphabet the first 4 letters are written in the opposite order, so it should be written like A, B, C, D. So this is what is the meaning. And next, EFGH, next 4 letter EFGH, then IJKL. Next MNOP, QRST, UVWX. And finally, Y and Z should be again interchanged, because till this, that 4-4 count is over. and two letters are left out. In, it is clearly mentioned in the question itself that Z and Y should exchange the position. Okay. So now the question is, what will be the fourth letter to the right of the 13th letter? If you count here, this is going to be the 13th letter, and right side is always this. Your right is always right. In reasoning, you have to take like that. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is the fourth letter from the 13th letter. The 13th letter, and T is the fourth letter to the right of 13th letter, which is P. So answer is T for that. Option B. Okay, next we'll see question number 13. This is a syllogism question. Some radio or mobile all the mobiles are computers. Some computers are watches. So again, you can just connect computer and watch without connecting the other two. But since watch is connected with computer and computer is connected with mobile and radio, this watch may have connect with mobile or it may have connect with radio also. Okay, so now conclusion one says that certainly some radios or watches. So definitely they are saying that radio and watch is connected. There is some connect, but it's not true. Certainly some mobiles or watches. Mobile and watch is connected. No, is it connected? It's not connected. No, it may have connect, but we are not sure. So both are wrong. So neither conclusion is neither one nor two. Okay, so option D is correct. Okay, 35. Seven books are there, P, Q, R, S, T, U, V. Out of that, R, Q, T are blue covers and others are red covers. S and U are new books, other books are old books. Then P, R, S are law books and other books are gazettes. So now we have to select old gazetteers with blue covers. Okay. So and there are options given. Option A, Q and R. This is basically using elimination technique. Okay. This could be answered in very few seconds. But since I'm explaining, I'm writing all these things. Okay. So first it should be blue. Okay. It has to satisfy that condition. So only R, Q, T are blue. Okay. So it can't be U. Okay. U is not blue book. So you can eliminate these two options based on that. And it should be old book. And it should be gazetteer. Okay. So P, R, S are not gazetteers. So since R is coming here, it is not a law book. It is a law book. It is not a gazetteer. Okay. So it should be eliminated. So answer is option C. Okay, 36. Three, two, 7, 4, 13, 10, 21, 18, 31, 28, 43 and 40. So now it's very clearly given. You have to replace the incorrect term where odd terms and even terms follow the same pattern. So it's very clearly given that odd term means first term, third term, these are odd terms. Okay. So which means 3, 7, 13, 21, 31, 43. Even terms are these. Two, 4, 10, 18, 28, 40. Okay. So what is the difference between these two numbers is 4, and the difference between these two numbers is 6. Here it's 8, here it's 10, here it's 12. Okay, but if you take here, here it's 2, here it is 6, here it is 8, here it is 10, here it is 12. So it's very clearly said that both follows the same pattern. Okay, they have clearly given that odd term, even term follow the same pattern. So what's clear from this is here it should be plus 4 only, because the above follows this pattern, so it should be plus 4 only. So why that logic is right is because you see all the other differences are 2 2, okay, but between 2 and 6 it's 4, so that's different. Okay, that is breaking the logic, so you have to change that only according to the above one. You may think that why the above one can't be changed as the below one, but the above one has a proper logic that difference is 2 2 everywhere, but the below one doesn't have logic, okay, which means that the correct one is the above one and the incorrect one is below one. First of all, we have to change that. We have to make it as 4. It should be plus 4. So what should be replaced here to make it plus 4 is 0. Instead of 2, if you put 0, now this makes a correct pattern of plus 4, plus 6, plus 8, plus 10, like that. So 2 is a wrong number, and instead of that you have to replace that with 0. So 0 is the answer, which is option A, and 0 is the answer. 37. Okay, 7B, 10A, 3C. So it's very clear that the subtraction of these two numbers gives you this, and 3C, 9B, and 6A. Again, it's very clear that subtraction of these two numbers will give you this, 10A, 13C. The subtraction of these two should give you 3. So here you find that A, B, C. Here in the second row also you find A, B, C. So third row also you should have all the three variable A, B, C. So B should be, B is missing, so it should be coming here. 3B is the answer. Answer is C. Next, 38. Okay, sequence 1 and sequence 2 are identical sequence. It's very clearly given that it's identical sequence. So 8, 4, 6, 15. So if something is decreasing like this to half, it's very clear that it's a multiplication of 0.5. So once we are multiplying a number with 0.5, the entire sequence continues using that 0.5 pattern. So this is 1.5, this is 2.5. This is 3.5 and this is 4.5. Okay, so now we need 5 A, B, C, D is given. You have to find out what is this. Okay, so here if you make it half, it will become 2.5. You have to follow the same pattern. Multiply this with 1.5, multiply this with 2.5. First, I found out the number A is 2.5. Next, 2.5 into 1.5 will give you 3.75, and then 3.75 into 2.5 will give you 9.375. Okay, so this is the answer. See. Next question, number 46, mathematics. Is coded as L, S, L, B, S, I, D, N, Z, U, H, D, R. So what is going to be the chemistry? So this is 13th letter and this is 12th letter, right? So it's minus 1. So the first letter, second letter, it's plus 1. It's like minus 1, plus 1, minus 1, plus 1. This pattern continues. Okay, so minus 1, it should start with minus 1, which means you have to write the previous letter of this. And here, plus 1, which means you should write the next letter of H, which is I. and here previous letter of E should be written, that is D, and here the next letter of M should be written, that is N. So this option is in B, and after this you don't have to proceed. Okay, so till this, if you find out, that is enough. From the option you can eliminate and select the correct one. So B is the correct answer. 55. So it's like meeting. If fifth day, another person is 24th day, and another person is coming every 9th day. So meeting itself means that we need a common number. For that, we have to take the LCM. If we take the LCM, we'll get 360. 360 is the least common multiple. So from Sunday, Sunday they are meeting, and after that, after 360 days they will meet. If you take the equivalent odd day for this, it's 3. So if you count from Sunday, after 3 days will be Wednesday. Okay, it's like Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. So Wednesday is the answer for this, B. Half of the villages, they didn't give you the total number of people, so I'm going to take it to be 100. Half of the villages, so 50% of the villages are owning their own house, and 50 people are rented house. 1/5 of the villager cultivate paddy. Okay, 1/5 means 20 people cultivate paddy, and remaining 80 other crop. Okay, next, 4/5 of the villagers are under 25. 1/3 of the villager are literate. Okay, among that 100, 1/3 means 33 people. It's not going to be 33.33, but then 1/3 is this. 33 are literate, remaining 66 are non-literate. 4/5 of the villagers are under 25 years of age. So 4/5 of this number is 80 people are under 25, and remaining 20 are above 25. Okay, so which of the among the given option, which is correct, is option B is correct. Why? Because you have to take each and every option and check, and among that B is definitely right, because some villages under 25 years of age are literate. Okay, we know that there are 33 people who are literate. Okay, they are combining these two conditions, and only 20 people are above 25 age. Okay, because 80 people are under 25, 20 people, remaining 20 people should be above 25. Suppose all the above 25 people are literate, there are 33 literate people. Okay, among that, if above 25 age people are all the people are literate, so remaining 13, at least 13 must be literate under 25, right? So there are some people who are under 25 who are literate. Okay, so B is the answer. So it's like overlapping. It overlaps. This value overlaps with that. So obviously, these people are present there. It's like that. So B is the answer. So why I'm taking this to be 100 is they didn't give you any value. Just for calculation, I have taken like that. 67. B is the answer, because using statement 1 you cannot find out, because the question which is based on what is 14th day of the month, a month is specified, and what is 14th day of that month, the last day of the month is Wednesday. So last day means it could be 28 days, a month could have 28 days or 29 days, 30 days or 31 days. We don't, since the month is not mentioned, we don't know what is going to be the last day. So last day is a question mark. Using that, you cannot find out what is 14th day. So statement 1 is not useful to find out the answer. If you take statement 2, the third Saturday of the month was the 17th day. Okay, 17th day is Saturday. So what is going to be the previous Saturday? 10th. And what is going to be the previous Saturday of that? 3rd. So since we know 10th is Saturday and 14th is going to be in between these gap, okay, it's going to be in these two, I mean in this interval only, so you can find out what is going to be the 14th day. Okay, so statement 2 is enough to find out the answer, and this is the calculation for it. Next is 68. It could be done in two ways. Okay, the examination, CSAT examination, was conducted on 10th October, yesterday. Okay, today is 11th October. 10th October is on Sunday, correct? So which means 10th October 2021 is Sunday. So 10th October 2022, 10th October 2023, 10th October 2024, 2025, 2026, 2027 is the question. So since the examination is conducted on this particular date, we can able to do like this, okay? But general calculation is not, that is different. I'll tell you that later. So that since yesterday was Sunday, the next October of the next year will come on Monday. Then it's going to be on Tuesday, and here it's 2024, so here one day, Wednesday, will not come. Thursday will be coming here, then Friday, then Saturday, then Sunday. So 10th October of 2027 will be on Sunday only. So there is another way to solve this, which is making normal calculation. So you should be knowing the concept of calendar clearly, then only you will understand what I say. September, this is a calculation. January, February, March, April, May, June, July, August, September. This contain how many leap years and non-leap years I'm going to see. 6 leap years and remaining 20 normal years. Okay, so here into 2, here into 1 you have to put 12 plus 20, 32. Okay, so 10 plus 5, 10, 15, 21. 32 has 4 odd days, so instead of this it's 0, and here it's 3, here it's 4, again it's 7, 7 equals 0, this is Sunday, 0 means Sunday. So this is a calculation, you must be knowing this concept already to understand this. Okay, next is 69. Some greens are blues, some blues are blacks. So this black may have connected with the green. Okay, so conclusion 1, some greens are black, some green and black is not connected. Okay, it's not connected all the time, so it's not right. Next, no green is black, so we cannot say like that. It may have connect also, so we cannot say that there is a disconnection, so it's wrong. All green or black, all, no, you are not finding one circle inside another completely, so the conclusion should not have the word all. The possibility is different, but they didn't mention any word based on possibility. Okay, so which means they are saying everything for sure, which is not right. So neither, none of the statement is right, so neither is the answer, D. So how this comes from this is very clear that it is a multiplication sequence, because it is getting increased fastly. Okay, the numbers are going greater, so it involves multiplication. So in 3 times plus 1. Okay, here it's 3 times plus 1. So in the sequence, if it goes into 3 plus 1 will give you 607. Okay, so next question is 75. 75 is option D. Here you have to use a trial and error method only, where you should try each and every option and see whether you get any pattern or not. Okay, you have to fill up option D here. Okay, A should be in the first blank, B should be in the second blank. Next, A, B, A, B. Okay, since it contains 18 letters, it should be divided into multiple. Which numbers are the divisors of 18? 2, 2, 2 you can divide, 3, 3 you can divide, 6, 6 you can divide. Like that you have to divide and see. Okay, if you divide it as 2, 2, A, B, B, A, B, there is no pattern forming. But if you divide it as 3, 3, it makes a proper pattern. Okay, A, B, B, A, B, A, B, B, A, B, like that. Okay, thank you.
Hi, everyone. So, we are going to take a look at the CSAT 2021 paper and see how, you know, the questions were. There were around 27 questions here, and most of the passages have one question. The difficulty level was moderate. I will take you through each passage and also tell you what should be the correct answer for each of them. So, first passage. The paper started with RC only. So, it says that fig trees, that is genus Ficus, are considered sacred in India, East Asia and Africa, and are common in agricultural and urban landscapes where other large trees are absent. So in the absence of other trees, these are fairly common. In natural forests, fig trees provide food for wildlife when other resources are scarce and support a high density and diversity of frugivores. Frugivores are fruit-eating animals. If frugivorous birds, that is fruit-eating birds and bats, continue to visit fig trees located in sites with high human disturbance, sacred fig trees may promote frugivore abundance. So this is pretty self-explanatory. If frugivores continue to come here, then fig trees will promote their presence. Under favorable microclimate, plenty of seedlings of other tree species would grow around fig trees. Okay, now the question here is, now also remember with these kind of questions, as we have discussed, you should use your options also to eliminate, because sometimes it gets a little confusing and in the exam you are in a time constraint, so using options is a good strategy, and of course you can verify it logically as well. So the following assumptions have been made. Number one, fig trees can often be a keystone species in natural forests. Keystone means important. So, does the author believe that? Well, yes, the author is talking about how, you know, these fig trees promote frugivores and how they can lead to, see the last line, other trees growing, because, you know, plenty of seedlings of other tree species would grow around fig trees. So, the first one seems to be a valid assumption made by the author. If you see your options, only A and D have the first one. So, let's proceed. Two says fig trees can grow where other large woody species cannot grow. Now, this is an extreme statement. And what do we do with extreme statements? We verify with the passage. If they're not supported, we eliminate them. Are they saying that fig trees are growing where other trees cannot grow? If you see, that is not the case. Because they're saying that these fig trees are there where other large trees are absent. Now, why are they absent? Is it because they can't grow or is it because of some other reason? We don't know that. So we can't say that the author believes in. So two is definitely wrong. Now check which options have two. So A is eliminated, C is eliminated. And now it's either B or D. And as we saw that one is a valid assumption. So it can't be B. The answer must be D. Answer must be D. Either way, if you see the third assumption is valid, let's check that. Sacred trees can have a role in biodiversity conservation. Yes, sacred trees, in this case, it is a fig tree. So that is given. That is very well correct. And the fourth one, Fig trees have a role in the seed dispersal of other tree species. Yes, that is supported in the last sentence. So your first answer should be D. First answer should be D. Then see the second passage. At the heart of agroecology is the idea that agroecosystems should mimic the biodiversity levels and functioning of natural ecosystem. Mimic means to copy. Okay. Such agricultural mimics, like their natural models, can be productive, pest resistant, nutrient conservant, and resilient to shocks and stresses. So these are all the benefits of these agricultural mimics. And it is given that in ecosystems, there is no waste. Nutrients are recycled indefinitely. This is presented as a characteristic. Agroecology aims at closing nutrient loops, that is, returning all nutrients that come out of the soil back to the soil, such as through application of farmyard manure. Okay. It also harnesses natural processes to control pests and build soil fertility. That is through intercropping. Okay, so using different kinds of crops. Agroecological practices include integrating trees with livestock and crops. Okay, so it's just a fact-based passage. Now see this, consider the following. There are six practices that are given. Which of the above farming practices can be compatible with agroecology as implied by the passage? Now you may get a little worried looking at this, because this passage doesn't directly talk about hydroponics or fertigation, but that doesn't matter. What you do is just see which ones are definitely covered, and then you can use the process of elimination. We can see, so hydroponics are those plants which are grown without soil, right? Grown only in water. This passage doesn't talk about any hydroponics. So please eliminate B and C. As soon as you eliminate B and C, your work becomes very easy. It's either A or D. Now, 4 is present in both, that is mixed farming. That is given as well, no? See, mixed farming is given, intercropping, they are talking about that. And are they talking about vertical farming? Vertical farming is that, you know, you grow crops indoors in stacks. That is not really mentioned. So D is also wrong. Your answer must be A, 1, 4 and 5. And you can verify it logically. Cover crops, yes, it is given. Same intercropping. Mixed farming, of course, it is given. Polyculture, yes, it is the process of, I think mixed farming is integrating livestock with that. But either way, all are given. 1, 4 and 5, all are given. Fertigation is not mentioned. It is the practice of the chemical irrigation. So that is not given. So 1, 4 and 5 will be the answer. On the basis of this, 1, 4 and 5 will be the answer. Cover crops, mixed farming and polyculture. Hydroponics and vertical farming are clearly not in the scope of this passage. Now see, passage 3, computers increasingly deal not just with abstract data like credit card details and databases, but also with the real world of physical objects and vulnerable human bodies. Okay, so all these things are being dealt with by these computers. A modern car is a computer on wheels, an aeroplane is a computer on wings. And he's saying that the arrival of the Internet of Things will see computers baked into everything, from road signs and MRI scanners to prosthetics and insulin pumps. So everything will have a computer. There is baked into means it will be built into it. There is little evidence that these gadgets will be any more trustworthy than their desktop counterparts. So we don't have much evidence that they'll be more trustworthy than the desktops that we have today. Hackers have already proved that they can take remote control of internet connected cars and pacemakers. So these devices are prone to hacking. So which of the following statements best reflects the most critical inference that can be made from the passage given above? Option A, computers are not completely safe. Yes, that can be inferred because they're talking about computers getting hacked. Option B, companies producing the software do not take cybersecurity seriously. He's not really blaming them. He's not saying that they're not taking cybersecurity seriously. So B is a bit of an extreme statement. You can eliminate it. It is wrong. See, stringent data security laws are needed. This passage does not talk about legislation. So C is wrong. And D, the present trend of communication technologies will affect our lives in future. This doesn't really talk about, you know, communication technologies. It's talking about computers and how they will become a part of different kinds of devices. So it's not really saying how it will affect our lives in the future. He's mainly talking about the threat of hacking or, you know, the lack of safety in these computers. So A is the answer. Third one is A. Then the fourth one, a social and physical environment riddled with poverty, inequities, unhygienic and insanitary conditions generates the risk of infectious diseases. Okay, fine. Hygiene has different levels, is classified into three. Number one, personal hygiene. Number two, domestic hygiene. Number three, community hygiene. There is no doubt that personal cleanliness brings down the rate of infectious diseases. And he says, but the entry of the market into this domain has created a false sense of security that gets conditioned and reinforced. Reinforced means strengthened by the onslaught of advertisements. So ads sort of give you a false sense of security that personal cleanliness is more important. That's what he means to say. Experience in Western Europe shows that along with personal hygiene, general improvements in environmental conditions and components like clean water, sanitation and food security have brought down infant / child death / infection rates considerably. So infant death and infant infection and child death and child infection rates have been brought down considerably by improving the general environmental conditions like clean water, sanitation and food security. This has been observed in Western Europe. The obsession with hand hygiene also brings in the persistent influence of the market on personal health, overriding or marginalizing the negative impact on ecology and the emergence of resistant germs. So this kind of an obsession with hand hygiene, for example, is not good for the ecology and also may create resistant germs, and nobody is really focusing on this. So what assumptions have been made here by the author? Number one, people who are obsessed with personal hygiene tend to ignore community hygiene. Not really, no. The author is not indicating anywhere that people who are obsessed with personal hygiene are not paying attention to community hygiene. So first one we know is not a valid assumption. You can eliminate options A and D. Okay, A and D can be eliminated. Then it's either B or C. Yeah. So we know that second one is anywhere not there. Okay. Second one, emergence of multi-drug-resistant germs can be prevented by personal cleanliness. No, rather the author is implying that too much focus on personal cleanliness is the reason behind the emergence of these drugs, of these germs. So two is anywhere wrong. We don't really have an option for it either. So leave it. Third one, entry of the market into the domain of hygiene increases the risk of infectious diseases. Yes, the author believes that because he says that this can lead to the emergence of resistant germs. So the third one is a valid assumption, which means my answer must be B then, 3 and 4, because 4 is anyway true for both. And 4 says, for both the options, I mean B and C, 4 is anyway true. Let's check what 4 is. Scientific and micro level interventions are not sufficient to bring down the burden of infectious diseases. The author does not indicate any such thing. Actually, no, he does. Scientific and micro level interventions are not sufficient to bring down the burden of infectious diseases. He does indicate that. Because he says that we also need this domestic and community hygiene. So sorry about that. Fourth is correct. Fourth is correct. Because he believes that personal hygiene is not sufficient. Fourth is correct. And fifth one, it is community hygiene implemented through public health measures that is really effective in the battle against infectious diseases. He's not saying community hygiene is most important. He's saying all three are important. And nowadays we tend to give too much emphasis on personal hygiene, which can actually be detrimental in some cases by creating some kind of resistant germs. So fifth is not really a valid assumption and you should choose B. Fourth one should be B, 3 and 4 only. Okay, so this was one set. Now, if you see, this time you were given questions in sets of 4 and sometimes in sets of 2, which was quite interesting. Now, see this passage 1. That is question number 11. with respect to what are called denominations of religion, if everyone is left to be a judge of his own religion, there is no such thing as religion that is wrong. But if they are to be a judge of each other's religion, there is no such thing as religion that is right. And therefore, all the world is right or all the world is wrong in the matter of religion. So he's saying that people think that their religion is correct, entirely correct, and all other religions are entirely wrong. So what is the assumption made by the author? So, A, no man can live without adhering to some religious denomination. No, what the author is saying is that people have a biased view. They perceive their religion to be all correct and other religions to be all wrong. So A is not in line with that. A is wrong. B says it is the duty of everyone to propagate one's religious denomination. Nothing of the sort has been given. So B is wrong. Option C, religious denominations tend to ignore the unity of man. Yes, because, basically they believe that their religion is correct and all other religions are wrong. So yes, that is definitely contrary to the unity of man. Because then there is no unity. That's what the author believes, that religious denominations ignore unity because somebody or the other will always be wrong. If your religion is all correct and other religions are all wrong, then somebody is always wrong. So C matches somehow. Let's check D. Men do not understand their own religious denomination. That is not indicated. What the author believes is they do understand and they believe that theirs is the only one that is correct. So C is the correct answer. 11th one should be C. 12th one, it is certain that seditions, wars, and contempt or breach of the law are not so much to be imputed. Imputed means attributed to the wickedness of the subjects as to the bad state of a dominion. So when these things happen, the blame should go to the dominion. Dominion is the country or province or whatever it is. For men are not born fit for citizenship, but must be made so. So becoming a good citizen is something that must be taught. Besides, men's natural passions are everywhere the same. And if wickedness more prevails and more offenses are committed in one commonwealth than in another, it is certain that the former has neither enough pursued the end of unity nor framed its laws with pursued the end of unity means focus on unity, nor framed its laws with sufficient forethought. And that, therefore, it has failed in making quite good its right as a commonwealth. So he's saying the blame should be assigned on the dominion and not on the citizens. Now, let's check the question. This is an inference-based question. Which among the following is the most logical and rational inference that can be made from the passage given above? Option A, seditions, wars, and breach of the laws are inevitable in every dominion. This is an extreme option. It's not really indicated that it is inevitable means unavoidable in every dominion. Eliminate it. Option B, it is not the people but the sovereign who is responsible for all the problems of any dominion. Second part is a bit extreme, but it is also supported by the passage. So we'll keep it on hold. It is correct. It conveys the message of the passage, but let's see if we can find a better option. Option C, that dominion is the best which pursues the aim of unity and has laws for good citizenship. That dominion is the best. Is it indicated here which dominion is best? It's talking about laws for good citizenship. That dominion is the best which pursues the aim of unity. So he's saying if a dominion has problems, it means that it has not pursued the end of unity enough and has not framed its laws with sufficient forethought. And it has failed in making quite good its right as a commonwealth. So it's best which pursues the aim of unity and has laws for good citizenship matches these two. Yeah. So C seems to be better. And D, it is impossible for men to establish a good dominion. That's also not indicated anywhere. C should be the answer. The answer should be C for this one. 12th one is C. Because B is also extreme. It's responsible for all the problems of any dominion. Again, that's not true. So we'll go for C. 12th one, C. Then passage 3, inequality violates a basic democratic norm, the equal standing of citizens. So inequality violates this. Equality is a relation that obtains between persons in respect of some fundamental characteristic that they share in common. Okay, fine. Equality is morally speaking a default principle, so it should be there by default. It should be, there should not be that inequality is a default principle and you have to work for equality. Equality should be the default. Therefore, persons should not be discriminated on grounds such as race, caste, gender, ethnicity, disability, or class. These features of human condition are morally irrelevant, he's saying. The idea that one should treat persons with respect not only because some of these persons possess some special features or talent, for example, skilled cricketers, gifted musicians, or literary giants, but because persons are human beings is by now part of common sense morality. So he's saying everybody should be treated with respect, not because they have some special kind of a talent. So what assumptions are being made here by the author? 13th one. First assumption is that equality is a prerequisite for people to participate in the multiple transactions of society from a position of confidence. Yes, the author does believe that, because he's saying that, you know, people must be treated as equal by default. So the first assumption is valid, which means it's either A or C. Second one, occurrence of inequality is detrimental to the survival of democracy. Yes, the author believes in that as well, because he's saying that inequality violates a basic democratic norm, equal standing of citizens. So two is also correct. So one and two, both are correct. Your answer must be A. Now let's check 3 and 4. 3 is equal standing of all citizens is an idea that cannot actually be realized even in a democracy. This is an extreme option. The author is not saying that you cannot realize equality. And fourth one, right to equality should be incorporated into our values and day-to-day political vocabulary. The author does not really deal with political vocabulary. So 4 is also wrong. So A is the answer. 13th one should be A. And then the 14th one, passage 4. Aristocratic government ruins itself, that is, spoils itself by limiting too narrowly the circle within which power is confined. Oligarchic semicolon, which means it's a new point. Oligarchic government, and oligarchy is a system where a few organizations run everything. Oligarchic government ruins itself by the incautious scramble for immediate wealth. So these are the problems with the aristocracy, that is royalty and oligarchy. And then he says, but even democracy ruins itself by excess of democracy. Its basic principle is the equal right of all to hold office and determine public policy. This is at first glance a delightful arrangement, so it's desirable. It becomes disastrous because the people are not properly equipped by education to select the best rulers and the wisest courses. So people are not competent enough. That's why it can become problematic. The people have no understanding and only repeat what their rulers are pleased to tell them. Such a democracy is tyranny or autocracy. This has been said by Plato. This entire thing has been said by Plato. So which of the following statements best reflects the crux of the passage given above? Option A, human societies experiment with different forms of governments. That's not indicated. Option B, any form of government tends to deteriorate by excess of its basic principle. Yeah. Correct, because aristocracy suffers from too much aristocracy. Oligarchy suffers from too much profit seeking. Democracy suffers from too much democracy. So A, B seems to be correct. Option C, education of all citizens ensures a perfect, functional and sustainable democracy. It's not focusing on education of citizens. C is irrelevant. And D, having a government is a necessary evil because tyranny is inherent in any form of government. The author is not really saying that tyranny is unavoidable, that it's a part of every government. So D is also wrong. The correct answer is B. 14th correct answer is B. Okay, let's move ahead to 21 to 24. Yeah. And next 4 questions. Okay. So question number 21. Researchers simulate street lighting on artificial grassland plots containing P. aphids, sap-sucking insects, at night. Okay, so these were exposed to 2 different types of light, a white light similar to newer commercial LED lights and an amber light. Amber means yellow. Amber light similar to sodium street lamps. The low intensity amber light was shown to inhibit means to prevent rather than induce. Induce means to promote flowering in a wild plant of the pea family, which is a source of food for the pea aphids in grasslands. The number of aphids was also significantly suppressed under the light treatment due to the limited amount of food availability. So that was another factor. Now, what is the most critical inference that can be made from this passage? Option A, low intensity light has more adverse effect on the plants as compared to high intensity light. This seems to be supported by the passage because the plants under amber light, so amber light was shown to inhibit it, right? That was not reported for the white LED lights. A seems okay. Let's check other options. Light pollution can have a permanent adverse impact on an ecosystem. Not really sure of the word permanent over here. So extreme option, eliminate it. White light is better for the flowering of plants as compared to light of other colors. We've not really compared with all colors. We've just seen white versus amber, where white is better, but we don't know about other colors. So C is also a vast generalization, which you can eliminate. And D, proper intensity of light in an ecosystem is important, not only for plant, but for animals too. We don't have any evidence of that. So A, 21, go for option A. Okay, question 21, go for option A. Then 22, approximately 80% of all flowering plant species are pollinated by animals, including birds and mammals, but the main pollinators are insects. So pollination is responsible for providing us with a wide variety of food as well as many plant-derived medicines. So these are the benefits of pollination. At least one third of the world's agricultural crops depend upon pollination. Bees are the most dominant taxa when it comes to pollination, and they are crucial to more than 400 crops. So this is the importance of bees. Pollination is an essential service that is the result of intricate relationships between plants and animals. And the reduction or loss of either affects the survival of both. So, you know, we can't. Both are essential. Effective pollination, he says, requires resources such as refuges of pristine natural vegetation. So we need to maintain some good natural vegetation for effective pollination to occur. Now they're asking, on the basis of the passage given above, the following assumptions have been made. So number one, sustainable production of India's cereal food grains is impossible without the diversity of pollinating animals. See the word impossible. Is it supported in the passage? You will see that no. He is not saying that diversity of pollinating animals is a prerequisite for producing cereal crops. One is an extreme option. Please eliminate it. So A is gone and C is gone. A and C both are wrong. Now check the second one. Monoculture of horticultural crops hampers survival of insects. We are not talking about horticultural crops. So two is also wrong, and which means my answer must be D then, three and four only. Let's logically verify three and four as well, though we already got our answer. Third one, pollinators become scarce in cultivated areas devoid of natural vegetation. Yes, he believes this because he's saying that effective pollination requires pristine natural vegetation. Pristine means undisturbed. And four, diversity in insects induces diversity of plants. Yes, that is also correct. Reduction or loss of either affects the survival of both, that is plants and animals. So the author believes in that as well. So three and four, both are valid assumptions. And my answer is D. 22 is D, three and four only. Now let's go to 23. A study conducted on the impacts of climate change over the Cauvery Basin of Tamil Nadu using regional climate models showed an increasing trend for maximum and minimum temperatures. So maximum temperatures are going up, minimum temperatures are reducing, and a decrease in the number of rainy days. So these are the impacts of climate change. These climatic shifts will have an impact on the hydrological cycles in the region, lead to more runoff and less recharge, and affect the groundwater table. So this will be the impact. Further, there has been an increase in the frequency of droughts in the state. This has driven farmers to increase dependency on groundwater resources to secure their crops, because not getting enough water from rain, so they're taking it from the ground. So which of the following statements best reflects the crux of the passage given above? So option A, development of regional climate models helps in choosing climate smart agricultural practices. The passage does not really deal with any climate smart agricultural practices. A is wrong. Option B, heavy dependence on groundwater resources can be reduced by adopting dry land cropping systems. There is no mention of any dryland cropping system, so B is also wrong. Option C, climate changes increase the criticality of water resources. That is the importance, yes. While simultaneously threatening it, yes, because we have fewer rainy days. So C is correct. C is the correct answer. And D, climate changes cause the farmers to adopt unsustainable livelihoods and risky coping strategies. Nothing of the sort has been given, that it is unsustainable. So, yeah. And neither is it given that the coping strategies are risky. They can be problematic, but he's not really saying that they're unsustainable or risky. So extreme options again, go for C. 23, choose C. That is the best answer. And 24, researchers were able to use stem cells to gauge means to measure the neurotoxic effects of the environmental pollutant bisphenol A or BPA. They used a combination of biochemical and cell-based assays to examine the gene expression profile during the differentiation of mouse embryonic stem cells upon treatment with BPA, a compound known to cause heart diseases. So they did this on mouse embryonic stem cells, diabetes and developmental abnormalities in humans. They were able to detect and measure BPA toxicity towards the proper specification of primary germ layers, such as endoderm and ectoderm, and the establishment of neural progenitor cells. So these were the things that they were able to measure. Now, what assumptions have been made here? Number one, BPA may alter embryonic development in vivo. BPA may alter embryonic development in vivo. So they did this on mouse embryonic stem cells. Yeah, and differentiation occurred. And yes, there were some changes in the endoderm and ectoderm and the establishment of neural progenitor cells. So one seems to be correct. Second one, biochemical and cell-based assays are useful in finding out treatments for pollution-induced diseases. This is not really covered in this passage, so 2 is wrong. So 2 is wrong, which means answer must be C only then. 1 and 3 only. Third one is embryonic stem cells could serve as a model to evaluate the physiological effects of environmental pollutants. Yes, correct. That's why they're doing it. They were able to use stem cells to gauge the neurotoxic effects of environmental pollutants. So that's exactly what they're doing. So 1 and 3 then. C is the answer. 24, the answer is C. Now we have to jump directly to what? 31, yeah? 31 to 34. This one. So India faces a challenging immediate future in energy and climate policy making. The problems are multiple, he's saying. First is sputtering fossil fuel production capabilities, limited access to electricity and modern cooking fuel for the poorest. That is second problem. Third problem, rising fuel imports in an unstable global energy context. And fourth one, continued electricity pricing and governance challenges leading to its costly deficits or surplus supply. And last one, and not least, growing environmental contestation around land, water, and air. So these are all the problems that India faces. But all is not bleak. So, you know, all is not gloomy or dark. Growing energy efficiency programs, integrated urbanization and transport policy discussions, inroads to enhancing energy access and security, and bold renewable energy initiatives, even if not fully conceptualized, means even if not fully developed, suggest the promise of transformation. So we do have hope. That's what the author is saying. We do have hope. So now, which of the following statements best reflects the critical message conveyed by the passage given above? Option A, India's energy decision-making process is ever more complex and interconnected. So is not really saying it's ever more complex. So A is wrong. Then B, India's energy and climate policy is heavily tuned to sustainable development goals. Yes, all these are sustainable development goals. So B is correct. Option C, India's energy and climate actions are not compatible with its broader social, economic, and environmental goals. None of the sort has been mentioned here. So that is wrong. And D, India's energy decision-making process is straightforward, supply-oriented, and ignores the demand side. This is off topic. So B is the only one that matches it. It is tuned to sustainable goals. B is correct. 31 should be B. Okay, 31 should be B. 32, there are reports that some of the antibiotics sold in the market are fed to poultry and other livestock as growth promoters. Overusing these substances can create superbugs, that is pathogens that are resistant to multiple drugs and could be passed along humans. So mindful of that, some farming companies have stopped using the drugs to make chickens gain weight faster. They stopped using these antibiotics. Since Denmark banned antibiotic growth promoters in the 1990s, the major pork exporter says it is producing more pigs and the animals get fewer diseases. So it has been proven to be a good measure. So what best reflects the critical message conveyed by the passage given above? Option A, people should avoid consuming the products of animal farming. No, what he's saying is banning these antibiotics turned out to be a good thing. B, foods of animal origin should be replaced with foods of plant origin. That's also not really indicated by the passage. C is correct. Using antibiotics on animals should be banned because they banned it and it gave a good result. And D, antibiotics should only be used to treat diseases. They're not talking about the only use of antibiotics. So they're only saying that antibiotics should not be given to these chickens. It was banned and it proved to be a good move. C is the only one that somewhat matches it. So 32 is a C. Moving on to 33. Okay, so coming to passage 3, that is the question number 33. Policymakers and media have placed the blame for skyrocketing fuel prices on a variety of factors. So there are different factors, including high fuel prices, bad weather in key food producing countries, and the diversion of land to non-food production. Okay. Increased emphasis, however, has been placed on a surge in demand for food from the most populous emerging economies. So this has been emphasized. It seems highly probable that mass consumption in these countries could be well poised to create a food crisis. These emerging economies, the mass consumption of food there is likely to create a food crisis in the future. Now, if we look at the question, so with reference to the above passage, the following assumptions have been made. Number one, oil producing countries are one of the reasons for high food prices. So, oil producing countries, is he talking about oil producing countries here? You'll see rather not than not. So, well, options are not really helpful over here. So, not really. There's no mention of oil producing countries here. It's talking about emerging economies, which is not synonymous with oil producing countries. Second one, if there is a food crisis in the world in the near future, it will be in the emerging economies, which means definitely it will be in the emerging economies. That's also not indicated. It's just highly probable. It's not a guarantee that it's going to happen. So, D is the answer. Neither one nor two. None of these assumptions are valid. Then question number 34, a central message of modern development economics is the importance of income growth, by which is meant growth in gross domestic product or GDP. So income growth equal to GDP. In theory, rising GDP creates employment and investment opportunities. As incomes grow in a country where the level of GDP was once low, household communities and governments are increasingly able to set aside some funds, which means allocate some funds for the production of things that make for a good life. So today, GDP has assumed such a significance, such an importance such a significant place in the domain, in the development lexicon. Lexicon is vocabulary. So development vocabulary, that if someone mentions economic growth, we know they mean growth in GDP. So economic growth has become synonymous with GDP. Now, what assumptions have been made here? Number one, rising GDP is essential for a country to be a developed country. Yes, that the author assumes that, because he's saying that economic growth nowadays is synonymous with growth in GDP. So to be a developed country, you have to improve your economy. So you have to increase your GDP. So the first one is correct. Second one, rising GDP guarantees a reasonable distribution of income to all households. It's not given here that rising GDP is synonymous with distribution of wealth. It's just the growth of wealth. So two is irrelevant and the answer should be A, one only. Okay, A should be the answer, one only. For question number 34. And moving on, we have two questions, that is 41 and 42. Yeah. So 41, the best universities like Harvard and MIT, despite having the luxury of having some truly excellent teachers on their payroll, are increasingly embracing the flipped classroom format, where students listen to video lectures at home and spend class time applying their knowledge, solving problems, discussing examples, etc. So he's saying that professors guide that discussion and fill in wherever necessary, explaining those bits that seem to be eluding the student. So whatever students can't understand, professors chime in to explain those parts. And throwing in advanced ideas that happen to be topical. So, and they come up with some advanced ideas. These universities have made their video lectures available free for anyone in the world. They are also encouraging colleges and universities all over the world to integrate these online courses into their own pedagogy. Pedagogy means teaching methodology, picking the pieces that are appropriate for their needs and building a package around them. So they're encouraging other universities to do the same, to basically use their courses. So which one of the following statements best reflects the central idea of the passage given above? So option A, efficacy of universities would be better in online mode of conducting classroom tuition as compared to conventional method. There is no comparison for the two. He's saying that reputed universities like Harvard and MIT are coming up with online courses. They're not saying that these online courses are better than the conventional classroom courses. So A is wrong. Option B, availability of higher education can be made easier and cheaper without diluting the content. We don't know whether it can be done without diluting the content. It's not really indicated anywhere in the passage. B is also wrong. C, we need not invest much in infrastructure related to higher education and yet develop better human and social capital. That's also not indicated. D says private sector institutions in higher education as well as coaching institutes can take advantage of this opportunity and thrive well. Yes, that is the main message conveyed here, because at the end it is saying that they are encouraging colleges and universities to use their courses for their own. So that covers in its scope coaching institutes as well. So D is the most appropriate choice for 41. 42, our cities are extremely vulnerable to climate change because of large concentrations of populations and poor infrastructure. So that's the problem. Moreover, population densities are increasing in them, but we have not yet developed the systems to address climate change impacts. So these are the shortcomings. Our cities contribute to 65% of the GDP, but there are not enough facilities to cater to the needs of the people. It is important to address the issues of air quality, transport, etc., that are vital to identifying sustainable solutions. So this needs to be done. So pretty self-explanatory, this passage. We need to involve citizens in city planning and create an ecosystem that meets the needs of the people. So yeah, so currently we are facing a lot of problems in the cities and we need to include the citizens in the planning of it. So question number 42 says, which among the following is the most logical and rational inference that can be made from the passage given above? Option A, our cities need to have well-defined administrative setup with sufficient autonomy. They're not really saying that the cities are not autonomous per se. So A is wrong. Option B, ever-increasing population densities is a hindrance in our efforts to achieve sustainable development. Ever-increasing population densities. He's saying that population densities are increasing. So probably, let's park it. Let's see if we have better option. Option C, to maintain and develop our cities, we need to adopt sustainability related interventions. That is also given here. It is important to address the issues of these things that are vital to identifying sustainable solutions. So it's between B and C. Option D says public-private partnership mode. Nothing about public-private partnership is given. So B is actually a generalization that ever-increasing population densities is a hindrance in our efforts to achieve sustainable development. We, the passage is only talking about cities, right? Ever-increasing population densities in cities. B is a generalization. So it's a little vague. I'd rather go with C, because C is city specific, specific to cities. So C is the answer. 42, the answer is C. To maintain and develop our cities, we need to adopt sustainability related interventions. 42 is C. Then let's move on to 51. So 51, 52, 53, these three questions on based on two passages. Sorry, it's a little blurred. I hope you are still able to read it. So for 51, the passage is medieval merchants risked the hazards of the Silk Road to reach the markets of China. Portuguese caravels in the 15th century sailed beyond the bounds of the known world, searching less for knowledge than for gold and spices. The main motivation was gold and spices and not knowledge. Historically, the driver for opening frontiers has always been the search for resources. Science and curiosity are weaker drivers. So he's saying the main reasons are related to money. The only way to open up space, whether the space of solar system or interstellar space, is to create an economic engine, and that engine is resource extraction. So if we can motivate people to go to space to extract resources, that will be more lucrative. So which one of the following statements best sums up the passage given above? Option A, wealth generation is the primary motive for any human endeavor. This is a very vast generalization. Not for any human endeavor. We can't say that. It's the primary motive when we are searching new places. So A is a bit generic, eliminated. Okay, so we were on question number 51. So yeah, we can't say that it's the primary motive for any human endeavor. Option B says space, whether space in solar system or interstellar space, will govern a future economy. So that is an extreme statement that definitely that is going to govern. That is not true. They're just talking about motivations for exploration, not whether it will govern a future. So B is wrong. Option C, human beings are motivated to explore new frontiers, principally by economic considerations. Yes. Because he's saying in the past it was gold and spices, and it is economic motivators are strong motivators, scientific motivators are weak motivators. See here it's given. Science and curiosity are weak drivers. The driver for opening frontiers has always been the search for resources historically. So C is correct. And D says wealth generation is based on the risk-taking behavior of some men. That is irrelevant to the passage. C is correct. 51. The correct answer is C. Then let's do 52 and 53. It's based on this short passage. Most people would agree that telling deliberate lies is wrong, except perhaps in certain special situations where more harm will be done by telling the truth. So there, people will agree that telling lies is okay. Even the most truthful people probably tell a good many more lies than might be regarded as semantic lies. Their use of words contains some measure of falsehood, more or less deliberate. So on purpose, they lie. So 52 is the idea which the first part of the passage mentions is. So it's talking about agreement, not about disagreement. And it's agreement about the reasons behind telling lies. That, you know, most people would agree that telling deliberate lies is wrong, except situations where more harm will be done by telling the truth. So it talks about an agreement about telling lies. There's no disagreement there. It talks about agreement about telling lies. 52 is A. Agreement about telling lies. And 53, which one of the following habits is found more often in good people? So that is B, intentional mixing up of truth with the false. Because it's given here that their use of words contains some measure of falsehood, more or less deliberate. So on purpose, they mix up truth and false. So B is better than A. 53rd answer is B. Then we have another three questions or four questions. Yeah, 61 to 64, four questions. So nothing can exist in a natural state which can be called good or bad by common assent, since every man who is in a natural state consults only his own advantage and determines what is good or bad according to his own fancy. Own fancy means his own desires. And insofar as he has regard for his own advantage alone and holds himself responsible to no one save himself by any law. And therefore, sin cannot be conceived in a natural state because people will just think about their own benefit. And then, according to them, nothing will be wrong because they're just seeing how they are benefiting out of it. So, sin cannot be conceived in a natural state. A sin is a wrongdoing, but only in a civil state, which is decreed by common consent what is good or bad. And each one holds himself responsible to the state. So, only in this kind of a scenario is there any meaning of a sin. So, what is the central idea of the passage? Option A says the conceptions of what is right or what is wrong exist due to the formation of a state. Exactly. That's exactly what is mentioned here. A is correct. B says, unless a ruling authority decides as to what is right or wrong, no man would be morally right. Not really, because morality would not exist. So that is irrelevant. Option C, man is inherently immoral and selfish in a natural state. Selfish, yes, immoral, nothing of the sort is given. D, the idea of what is right or wrong is necessary for the survival of human species. Survival of human species. Nothing is given about survival of human species. Nothing can exist in a natural state which can be called good or bad, but still it will exist, just not labeled good or bad. So there's nothing given about existence or survival. So A is the answer. 61 is A. 62. In the immediate future, we will see the increasing commodification of many new technologies. Artificial intelligence and robotics, 3D manufacturing, custom-made biological and pharmaceutical products, lethal autonomous weapons, and driverless cars. All these things will happen. This will pose conundrums. Conundrums means confusions. The moral question of how a driverless car will decide between hitting a jaywalker and swerving and damaging the car has often been debated. A jaywalker is a person who is walking on the road where they're not supposed to be walking. The answer is both simple, save the human life, and complex. At which angle should the car swerve? Just enough to save the jaywalker or more than enough? If the driverless car is in Dublin, who would take the decision? The Irish government or the car's original code writer in California or a software programmer in Hyderabad to whom maintenance is outsourced? So these are all the questions that are posed. How will the car decide what to do? If different national jurisdictions have different fine print on prioritizing a human life, how will it affect insurance and investment decisions, including transnational ones? So these are all the questions that are posed in this passage. The question 62, which of the following statements best reflect the rational, plausible, and practical implications that can be derived from the passage given above? So number one, too much globalization is not in the best. The author is not really saying that this is a bad development. So one is wrong, and because one is wrong, my answer is C, 2, 3, and 5 only. But let's check. Two says modern technologies are increasingly blurring the economic borders. Yes, the example of the driverless car in Dublin is given, so correct. Third one, innovation and capital have impinged on the domain of the state. Yes, because now it is transnational. Four, public policy of every country should focus on developing its own supply chains. Irrelevant, so wrong. And five, geopolitics will have to reconcile to many ambiguities and uncertainties. Yes, That's what he's focusing on by asking all these questions. So 2, 3 and 5, C is the answer. I mean, you can get it easily by eliminating, but logically, this is how you can check your statements after choosing the correct answer. But definitely use elimination, and you should be able to eliminate one, because he's not indicating anywhere that too much globalization is bad for all countries. So, passage 3, the resolution of bankruptcy cases in Indian banks. So, yeah, the answer for this question number 62 is C, 2, 3 and 5 only. Moving on, passage 3, the resolution of bankruptcy cases of Indian banks under the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code should help bring non-performing assets or NPA situations under some control. Despite the slow pace of resolutions by the National Company Law Tribunal, the code can be helpful in cleaning up bank books in future credit cycles. So, okay, let's see how this will be done. The recapitalization of public sector banks too can help increase the capital cushion of banks and induce them means to motivate them to lend more and boost economic activity. Okay, but bad debt resolution and recapitalization are only a part of the solution, as they by themselves can do very little to rein in means to control reckless lending that has pushed the Indian banking system to its current sorry state. So he's blaming the reckless lending. Unless there are systemic reforms that address the problem of unsustainable lending, future credit cycles will continue to stress the banking system. So reforms must be made. Otherwise, this problem is not going to get resolved. So question number 63, logical, rational and practical suggestion implied by the passage. Option A, lending by the bank should be closely monitored and regulated by the central government. There's no indication of regulation by the central government, so ignore it. Option B, interest rate should be kept low. There is no mention of any interest rates either, so B is wrong. Option C, merger of many banks into few large banks. Again, this is off topic. And D, Indian banking system requires structural reforms as a long-term solution for bad loans problem. Yes, the author is focusing on bad loan problems, and he is definitely saying that unless there are systemic reforms that address this problem, it will continue to stress the banking system. So D is the answer. 63, the answer is D, by elimination, and then finally by logical correlation. So 64, in India, the objective of macroeconomic policy is to enhance the economic welfare of the people, and any one wing of such macro policy, macro means big, overall, monetary or fiscal, monetary refers to the banking income and expense, and fiscal refers to government income and government expense. So they cannot independently work without active support of another. So what best reflects the corollary? Corollary is a conclusion. Option A, central bank cannot work independently of the government. Yes, exactly. That's what is given here, right? Monetary is RBI, fiscal is the government. So they cannot independently work. So A is exactly what is indicated. And A is the answer. Option B, government should regulate financial markets and institutions closely. There's no such indication. Option C, market economy is not compatible with the socialist policies of the government, not indicated. Option D, financial sector reforms are required for enhancing the economic welfare of the people. It doesn't talk about the economic welfare of the people. A is the answer. 64 is A. And the last two questions, yeah, 60, 71 and 72, yeah. Let's do this. So 71 passage is, can a democracy avoid being a welfare state for long? Can a democracy avoid being a welfare state for long? Okay. Why cannot mass welfare be left entirely to the market? So why should there be intervention? Why can't we leave it to the market? There is a built-in tension between markets and democracy. Markets do not work on a one person, one vote principle as democracies do. So that is the difference. What one gets out of the marketplace depends on one's endowment, skills, purchasing power, and the forces of demand and supply. Markets reward individual initiative and skill and may also lift many people from the bottom rungs of society. But some people never get the opportunity to develop skills that markets demand. They are simply too poor and too handicapped. or skill formation takes too long. So these are the problems. By creating jobs, markets may be able to help even unskilled people. But capitalism has always witnessed bursts of unemployment. So some problem will always be there. So 71, with reference to the above passage, the following assumptions have been made. Number one, modern democracies rely on market forces to enable them to be welfare states. No, it's not indicated that they rely on market forces. One is wrong. Since one is wrong, it's either B or C. So B says, so the second one is that markets ensure sufficient economic growth necessary for democracies to be effective. Again, nothing of the sort is given. So then the answer must be B, three only, that government programs are needed for those left behind in economic growth because the market is not going to guarantee it. So only the third assumption is valid, that is option B. And the last question, that is 72. In our schools, we teach our children all that is there to know about physics, math, and history, and what have you. But do we teach them about the bitter caste divide that plagues the country, about the specter of famine that stalks large parts of our land, about gender sensitivity, about the possibility of atheism as a choice, etc.? So do we teach them about all these things? He asks. Equally important, do we teach them to ask questions or do we teach them only to passively receive our wisdom? From the cocooned world of school, suddenly the adolescent finds himself or herself in the unfettered means unsheltered, world of university. Here, he or she is swept up in a turmoil of ideas, influences, and ideologies. And for someone who has been discouraged from asking questions and forming an opinion, this transition can be painful. So he's highlighting how, there's a huge difference between how the environment is when you are in school and when you leave school and go out into the real world. So what best reflects the central idea of the passage given above? So A, school curriculum is not compatible with the expectations of children and parents. Expectation of children and parents is a little vague here, not really mentioned, but we'll still park it. Let's see if we can find a better option because it does talk about the incompatibility. So option B, emphasis on academic achievements does give time for development of personality and skills. You know, it does not. The author is saying exactly the opposite. Option C, preparing the children to be better citizens should be the responsibility of the education system. He's not really saying that they should be responsible. And D, to be a better citizen, the present world order demands societal and life coping skills in addition to academic content. This is better because the author mainly is saying that academic content is not enough. Because when they go to university, they are faced with other ideas, influences, and ideologies for which they're not really ready. So it's not really talking about expectations of children and parents. It's rather talking about the demands that are placed, which are outside the academic content. So D is the best answer. For 72, the best answer is D. So that was the discussion of these questions. I hope the explanations are clear to you. Thank you.